Real Chat episode 49, Star Wars episode 3, Revenge of the Sith.
Boo.
The dark side of the Force is a pathway to many abilities some consider to be unnatural.
Is it possible to learn this power?
Not from a Jedi.
The Council wants you to report on all the Chancellor's dealings.
That's treason.
We are at war, Anakin.
Very dangerous putting them together. I don't think the boy can handle it. I don't trust him.
I need your help, son.
I'm appointing you to be my personal representative on the Jedi Council.
You're on this council, but we do not grant you the rank of master.
What?
Obi-Wan and the council don't trust me.
Learn to know the dark side of the Force, and you achieve a power greater than any Jedi.
You're under arrest, Chancellor.
Are you threatening me, Master Jedi? Every single Jedi is now an enemy of the Republic. Do what must be done. Do not hesitate. Show no mercy.
Who could have done this?
Twisted by the dark side, young Skywalker has become.
I feel so helpless.
Chosen one! A long time ago in a galaxy far, far away. Everybody, welcome to episode 49 of Real Chat, a podcast that promises week in, week out, the real world as we know it. Today, we're looking at the third and final installment of the Star Wars prequel trilogy, 2005's Star Wars Episode 3, Revenge of the Sith. There seems to be a defense of this film that because it's the best of the prequel series, it gets a pass mark. No, it doesn't. Saying Revenge of the Sith is the best of the three prequel films is like saying you'd rather have irritable bowel syndrome than diarrhea or hemorrhoids. The last brick in Lucas's bland and ridiculous prophecy about Anakin being the chosen one is Lucas's final attempt to imbue Star Wars with seriousness and significance, and in a word, it's underwhelming. Lucas simply doesn't have the ability to write films with interesting ideas or characters. But, on the upside, it's a little less terrible, and we get to see Anakin get burnt to a crisp, while Jar Jar Binks doesn't even have a single speaking appearance.
Yeah, it's not Anakin getting burnt, it's bloody Hayden Christensen getting burnt to a crisp, exactly what should happen to him.
Exactly right, bro.
We see the death of Anakin Skywalker and the death of Hayden Christensen's career in the same moment!
Exactly
right.
And
it's brilliant!
It's brilliant.
And
brilliant.
Actually, didn't Jar Jar Binks, wasn't he the one that gave emergency powers to the Chancellor?
Yeah.
Correct.
Ruined everything.
Exactly right.
Yeah, he's an asshole too. They're all assholes.
My name is Adam Stolfo, and I'm joined here as usual by good friend and co-host Brose Avard. Brose, how's it going?
Look, I'm okay. I don't know, I didn't think I'd ever say this, but God, I'm sick of Star Wars. Can we look at something else now, please?
We're like weeks away from the seventh one,
Brose. Oh, I could give two shits about The Force Awakens. Can't I just watch a musical?
The prequels have done this to you over the course of,
they've killed me.
Wow.
They've just killed
me.
This
can only help the film, bro. These three movies being in existence can only help this new one.
I don't know. Anyway, let's look at Sith.
Welcome, Brose. Welcome.
Yep, welcome.
Welcome back as well, Mr. James Hazelden. James, good to have you back, my friend.
Oh, fuck these trilogies. Fuck these films. Fuck you guys.
You'd think we've just walked the Kokoda Trail, for Christ's sake.
It's
like, I'm so exhausted. Why'd you make me do that?
God damn it.
Oh, I had such good memories.
I understand, though, you know, people's... like, I think Brose has really encapsulated the fact that, like, the original trilogies killing of the joy, like in people. I think that's yeah. exactly right. And what's really interesting is in your introduction, something I'd never thought of before, but I really liked, is I think you're right. I think the pompousness of the original trilogy comes from George Lucas's attempt to make it something other than what it was, which was a fun action adventure yarn, which is what those first, you know, the original trilogy is.
Yep.
And yeah, the idea, I hadn't heard it put that way before. I like it, the idea that it needed to be more important. Oh, there needs to be significance to it. And that's, it sort of sinks under its own need to be something other than
some type of self-justification.
Yeah, an entertaining series of films. Like, he is trying to make this first trilogy the Bible. It's prophecies and destinies and everything's connected to everything else. It needn't have been that way. It could have just been another three fun movies. And it's not.
It's not fun.
It's not fun.
And just quickly as well, this is the very first time you actually saw this film, right, James?
That's correct. I got my heart broken back in the 90s and early 2000s when the first two movies came out. So I saw Phantom Menace at the cinema, was disgusted with it in the penis, and then saw...
That's a very interesting reaction. Then saw, not visceral, it's penisceral.
Saw Attack of the Clones and got stabbed in the penis by it. And then just went, I value my penis. I don't want to be stabbed again.
See,
so
I didn't pick up any homoerotic undertones in these films.
It
but
was.
James is feeling it all in the dick.
I don't know. I just felt all of it in the dick. But I just went, you know what? I'm done. And so I hadn't seen the third one ever.
And, of course, we have a special guest with us here today as well, Jade Goodge. Jade, hey. Welcome to Real Chat.
Thank you so much. I'm really excited to be here.
For those of you who don't know Jade or Janis Malicious, which we're going to get into as well, as you know him professionally, you're a Melbourne-based musician, singer, songwriter, and doctor.
Correct. Yeah.
Wow.
Except they don't know me as Janis Malicious. They just know me as Jade.
Dr. Malicious, anybody?
Malicious.
Is this going to hurt? Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Shouldn't I have anesthetic? Yeah. No.
Alongside all of that, longtime sci-fi and fantasy appreciator, you never crack under the pressure of an escape room or laser battle.
Correct.
And you could probably hold your own in the zombie apocalypse.
Yeah. Yeah, I think so. I think the medical knowledge plus like martial arts background would be holding me in good stead.
That's good to know. Absolutely. Because in the zombie apocalypse, I'm fucked.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, have you seen zombie films? The fat guy's going down early. They're making a meal out of him. So if I just hide behind you, is that okay? Is that good?
You get a couple of good jokes in before
I get a couple of good jokes in, yeah.
And you're also, Jade, a huge Doctor Who and Dune fan.
Yes.
Wow. Like, I mean, Doctor Who's been going for that long and that many different...
How far back do you go?
How far back?
Well, I think the Tom Baker years is probably about the age I was hiding behind the couch from the Daleks.
Got it.
So. Were you scared of the washing machine as well? Because the Daleks aren't that scary.
No.
Same idea.
This is an episode of our Vintage Vault retrospective series, a conscious effort to tie in selected shows with something of relevance to the present. And I'm sure you'll all agree that there is no bigger year to look back at the Star Wars saga, with The Force Awakens opening on December 18th, undoubtedly one of the most anticipated movies of all time, especially in light of Disney acquiring the franchise rights and promising not only a third trilogy, but a bunch of Star Wars spin-off films as well. Now, guys, something I've just noticed, maybe I'm a little bit behind on this, but they have actually dropped Episode 7 from this, haven't they?
Yeah, you mentioned
it's just called Star Wars The Force Awakens.
You mentioned in the Clones episode, I think, as well. Yeah.
So
yeah, it's Star Wars The Force Awakens, which is interesting.
So why would they do this?
But the other thing, too, is the first spin-off film apparently comes out next year.
Right.
So we've got Force Awakens 2015 and then the spin-off Rogue One or whatever it is, 2016.
So what do you think be part of the reason why 7 would just be dropped off this
one? I think it's to do with the number of characters that Twitter allows you to use. I just think it's going to be easier to cyber promote this motherfucker, you know, if they just... And it's not as big a mouthful. It's already a mouthful.
Yeah,
why add more words?
I think they're also trying to distance themselves from the prequels a little bit.
Yeah.
I think they're trying to say, you know, Episode 1, 2 and 3, let's forget the numbers.
I think not just the prequels.
I don't know.
I think they're trying to distance themselves entirely and they're saying, this is the new start. This is Disney now. Like, this is our first one. Like, yeah, I don't know. I think they're actually trying to...
And, you know, it's a really smart suggestion from a Disney executive, because we're never going to remember the other six films that already exist. And it's stupid.
But also Kenneth Branagh, this is true. Kenneth Branagh back in the 90s made Henry V. It was his debut film as a director. And he made Henry V, or as it was known, you know, Henry and the V, Henry V. And people didn't go and see it in the States rights because they hadn't seen the first four Henry films. You don't want to muddy those waters. You don't want to confuse people. Do I need to see it? No, you don't. Just go and see this film. It's fine. It's fine. Even if you've never seen any Star Wars movie before, if you've been alive for the last few years, you've got enough Star Wars culture that's permeated you through the ether. You'll be fine with this movie. And I think that's also what they're saying.
Yeah, I'd agree with you there.
Also worth noting, for The Force Awakens, we're going to Periscope. Our response to the film. So we're going to see the film in the first couple of days and then we'll Periscope. So people that don't know what Periscope is, because I have no bloody clue, video online streaming thing. You can Twitter in questions.
It's online, broadcasting.
There you go.
Get in a submarine.
We'll be on Periscope. We'll announce the date later on, but it'll be happening probably within 2 or 3 days after Force Awakens, and then episode 50 for real chat will be The Force Awakens.
You should live stream you actually watching the movie, and it's just a series of people telling you to shut the fuck up. I always wonder that, because like there are people who online on Twitter who go, I'm going to live tweet me watching this movie, and I thought, you fucking bastard, don't do that. Your little screen will light up the theater and people are going to be annoyed. You should totally do that.
I know.
Yeah, let's do it. Just that, upset James.
Yes, but this is a little experiment, isn't it, Brose? This whole Periscope thing.
Yeah, we'll see how it goes.
We're just going to give it a shot, and if we can get ourselves a few more fans, it'll definitely be worth it. That's for sure.
And then I'll be Periscoping myself, showering every morning, and I'll see how far we can take this technology, because I think the fans of Real Chat want to know. I think they really want
to
know.
Let's go back 10 years, guys, to the last theatrical Star Wars release. This one, Revenge of the Sith.
It is one of the bizarre things that gets thrown around with The Force Awakens. They keep talking about, the Phantom Menace is only, whatever it is, 16 years ago, and this one's only 10 years ago. That seems so recent, but those films seem so far away in my mind. Maybe just because I've
pushed right to
tried,
the back
yeah,
memory.
Exactly. I've pushed them right. Like, 10 years ago is not that long ago, really, in film talk. Like, 2005 we're talking, aren't we?
Yep.
Yeah, that's not that long ago, but there you go.
Quickly, right off the bat, guys, initial thoughts on this one. I'll start over here. I'll start with our guest, Jade, today.
So, Revenge of the Sith, or otherwise the hypocrisy and inconsistencies in Anakin Skywalker.
Yes. See, that's a subtitle.
It's too long a title. Would never play on Twitter. That's the problem.
It's probably why it wasn't the original title and they had to forego it for something a little simpler.
Well, I think George Lucas wanted to call it Revenge of the Sith / Anakin Skywalker is Jesus Christ and I am God.
I think that was also, that would have been good.
That would have been a good title.
I would have watched that too. Well, it was the least worst option of all the prequels.
Isn't that great? It's the nicest thing you can say about something.
that's really least, telling,
it's
isn't
least
it?
Worst.
I suppose I originally tried to look for positives because I spent most of my life trying to pretend that the prequels were never made. Mm-hmm. After I saw The Phantom Menace, I didn't bother seeing the next two when they came out, and I just kind of happened upon them. And I've only seen them once, where the original trilogy, I've seen them multiple times, but I rewatched everything just because I knew that I was coming here. I was really excited when Brose said, "Oh, coming, we're doing Star Wars," and I was like, "Yeah!" And he was like, and he was like, and he was like, "Yes."
Yeah, we've done that at James a couple of times.
But I think that reaction actually is the reaction that everyone who went and saw this movie was. Oh my god, it's Star Wars! Oh my god, it's Star Wars!
Yeah,
I know.
Can you imagine if someone said, "Oh, come over and have a look at my Star Wars toys," and they were all like just prequel toys, and you'd be like, "What is this shit?"
Just a room full of Jar Jar.
A room full of Jar Jar.
Binks and Gabor.
Well, there wasn't as much Jar Jar in this, so that was a positive.
Yep.
And another positive, I think, is maybe Hayden Christensen's Anakin wasn't quite as rapey and creepy as in Attack of the Clones.
Nowhere near as rapey. What is it with rapey Anakin?
Oh, he had this look about him in the first one that made me shudder in a bad way.
But imagine looking out your window and there's Darth Vader in the full kit watching you from another apartment through binoculars. Like, that's what Anakin's performance is.
Do you know what? It'd be better than having Anakin Skywalker looking in at you.
He is creepy. He is really a creepy man.
And it had a more coherent storyline than the other two. But
well, I think
that had direction.
Had a bit of direction.
We were going somewhere. Like in the first one, it's like, where are we? Why are we going?
It had a storyline.
Yeah. And we got to go back to Tatooine, and we were all looking forward to that.
That's been sort of hinted upon in the entire first two films finally actually starts to kick in.
Yeah.
That's the other big compliment I can give this film, is it actually starts.
Yeah. I think the whole all of the prequels feel to me like a really long prologue, like the part that you just skim read in a really good epic book anyway.
Yeah, it's a footnote. They're all footnotes.
Yeah.
Appendices.
But what do you think, Brose? What are your initial thoughts with this one?
It's better. It's better. I mean, if you ignore Hayden Christensen, it's not terrible. There's some, he tries to fill the screen with far too much of the time. There's that shot of that when one of the Jedi is getting murdered at the end. There's a weird flower planet. Do you remember the big colourful flower planet? Anyway,
yeah.
And he talked about how great that was because it's the first time we've created a planet from scratch and it doesn't have any relevance to, you know, reality or anything. It's just a complete creation of my imagination or whatever. It's like, I don't think he gets it. The thing that works in the original films is that you go to Hoth, but you know it's an alien planet, but it also is very familiar. You go to Dagobah, it's a swamp. We get it, right? It's a swamp, but there's alien creatures around, and it's a slightly different, but it's still something we can relate to. Same with Endor, it's a forest moon. Right, forests, we fucking get it. It's a bit weird looking. It's not like a forest that we've seen before with those big vertical trees. Obviously, it exists in real life, but it's, you know, it's something a little bit exotic, but also very relatable. Him just talking about that flower planet is just proves he has no fucking idea.
I think James Cameron would disagree with you, bros.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's less about filmmaking and more about spectacle. That little comment that he makes is kind of is like a metaphor for the whole prequel series. What he thinks Star Wars is about, and I get it, it's his creation, but what he thinks is great about Star Wars is not what we think is great about Star Wars.
I think that's the point, is that Star Wars belongs to the fans now, not to him.
And he's well aware of that now, don't worry. Yeah. Fans have well and truly let him know at this point.
Well, I mean, that was the point. The point I made in the Phantom Menace podcast was the real betrayal for all the Star Wars fans is to find out that George Lucas is not a Star Wars fan.
Yeah.
He hasn't watched the movies as many times.
Turns out he's not much of a filmmaker either.
But he doesn't know enough about his own universe, and he doesn't understand why it's popular. Mm. And there's never been more proof of that than these three terrible movies.
Did you see that interview with him recently, and just like maybe the last week or two, in which he said that he's never going to be making another film ever again because he just gets criticised?
Yeah, I didn't see the interview, but I heard the applause.
My newsfeed's been full this week with that headline from different news sources, and I haven't bothered reading it because I really don't care.
But that's pretty much it. Yeah. That's what he says. He goes like, you know, like, no, I'm not interested in making any more movies because you just come out and get criticised for trying to, like, you know, show your vision.
He's the last person to be over it.
Really? Yeah.
What about yourself, James? Look, what are some of your initial thoughts on this one?
Look, I agree. I mean, I agree with Jade in that it's not a bad plot. Like, unlike Phantom Menace, which is terrible, I thought Attack of the Clones, on paper, the plot is really, really good. It's just fucked up in terms of pacing and character. But once again, let's look at the plot on paper. The Emperor's subtle rise to power by wiping out both his enemies and his allies... That's good. And Anakin sent in as a spy for the Jedi only to be caught between his loyalty to Obi-Wan and his need to learn the black arts because he thinks it'll save his wife. That all sounds great. Meanwhile, the Emperor has introduced a secret protocol into the clone droids the Jedi are using to destroy the actual Jedi. All good, all good. And unfortunately, it's just... We just have short exposition scene after short exposition scene that only serve to slow the already leaden pace of this very long movie. And once again, George Lucas just doesn't trust us. He doesn't trust us to get what's going on. He has to have two characters just tell us everything that's going on in a clunky, slow-moving, green screen kind of way. And, you know, the Attack of the Clones was marred by all of those terrible, pointless scenes with Hayden Christensen and Natalie Portman talking at one another.
Some which carry across into this one
no
as well,
James.
There.
No chemistry
no
there.
No chemistry.
No.
No.
And as Natalie Portman looks like that, it was one day of filming for her. It really does look like... Look, stand against this green screen background. Yep. Well, where am I? Doesn't matter. Well, what am I saying? It doesn't matter. Just
put
talk
your
for
lip
an
gloss
hour
on and talk.
But you know, you know that Christopher Lee, literally, one day of filming.
Yeah,
that's all he was available for.
Well, he doesn't do much in this except menacing, and then his stuntman does all the work.
Yeah, but it's still it's an insane idea. He's quite a major character. One day, that's all we can get out of him. So instead, we get more of whatever that other Grievous bullshit.
Can we talk about the fact, once again, just that the bullying thing in this thing is, once again, we have two young, fit Jedi taking on one old man? Who am I barracking for in that? He's 90. Could you leave him alone, man from Trainspotting and man from no future career? like, isn't that the worst of the Jedi's? The worst of the worst in that film and the last film? It's not cool. One old man, he's got a lightsaber. He's doing well. Let him win.
I know. Send in Anakin, and if I'm Obi-Wan, I'm just going to sit back and go, wow, that guy can actually swing a... Well, Saber pretty well for a 98-year-old. This is fascinating.
Oh, we beat him. We killed the 90-year-old man. Great. Good for you guys.
Yeah, the 70-year-old man told you to kill a 90-year-old man. Well, I'm not going into a nursing home ever again.
Now for going and killing, like, all the preschool kids.
Oh, yeah. Both ends of the scale.
Yeah.
You've got to complete
the set. There's a real demographic in Star Wars. We only kill people who are of no threat to us at all if we're the good guys.
Yeah. So, Revenge of the Sith is a Lucasfilm release. It was released on the 19th of May 2005 in the US and Australia. It was shot primarily in Fox Studios in Sydney, Australia, and also the Elstree and Shepparton Studios in England and the UK, as well as Tunisia again, Brose. But the most interesting thing with this one compared to the others is it had some second unit stuff shot in Italy, Thailand, Switzerland, and China.
Where's Padme from? Naboo?
Naboo.
The palace in Naboo is an Italian palace. It's a real palace. So that would have been the same for the first two films as well. The stuff in Asia, a lot of it is the backgrounds of the Wookiee planet.
Oh, okay.
They use real plates for those. So they photographed actual mountains and vistas and things, and that's what they use for the plates. And also in Italy, the volcanic explosions and stuff. This is awesome, right? So George Lucas is sitting on his ass watching the news, and it says, oh, there's a volcano erupting in Italy. So he sent the producer and the DOP, I think, over to Italy to film lava flows and
That's
explosions
awesome.
And stuff, and then they used those in
That's
the film.
Great.
Yeah, it's because they're like, how do we animate lava? It's impossible, but they didn't.
Yep.
Yeah.
The budget for this Star Wars film was
120?
113.
Oh, less than the first two.
Yep.
They were 120 each.
But of course, it did gross 848.8 million worldwide.
That's insane, isn't it?
Why?
Which was $200 million more than Attack of the Clones.
It's Stockholm Syndrome. People had to see the ending. They had to know. They didn't want to know, but they'd been there. They were so invested. They just went, you know what? It's just one more film. Let's just see it, and then we're done.
I think it's also...
like a round of vaccination.
I remember when this film came out, there was the expectation that it was going to be the good one. Like, I don't know how that permeated. I don't know if it was the marketing or if it was... I remember I went and saw it because I'd kind of given up as well, but I went and saw it at the cinema because... I know there was a feeling that this was going to be all right. It was the Anakin. Maybe it was just the Anakin Obi-Wan fight at the end that
and
people
also,
were anticipating.
People wanted to see Darth Vader become Darth Vader. That's an interesting arc.
The other thing too is I think people wanted it to be good. I think people, like, part of the goodwill around this film is the idea that Star Wars fans in general just thought this is going to be the good one, whether it is or isn't. We're going to say it's good, and we won't see it ever again. And it'll be 10 years later, and we'll just walk around going, "No, that was good. That was a good film. That was a good one. That was the good one. That's good. And it's not at all, but." We just willed it into our own consciousness to be a good film.
Here's the sad thing, bros. It was also the second highest grossing film in the Star Wars franchise as well. So it's way up there.
But that's not with adjusted gross, though.
No.
And that's what's impressive about Star Wars A New Hope is that it's so far ahead of the others just in 1977 money.
It was also the highest grossing film of 2005 in the US and the second highest grossing film of 2005 behind Harry Potter and the Goblet of Fire.
Yeah.
So you're right. Yeah, people flock to this one. And like you said, like, you know, hoping for something better.
Yeah.
But I think the expectations were so low after the first two.
I put it like this. Look, a lot of people wander around saying, thank God it's Friday. I've never understood the phrase, thank God it's Friday. Because what they're saying is, thank God it will soon be Saturday. It's like saying, oh, I've got a spike in my leg. Thank God, because when it's taken out, it's going to feel better. And that's what this movie is. It's like saying, thank God the next film in the chronology is A New Hope. That's what everyone's saying. Thank God.
Yeah, right. Thank episode God 3 gets us so much closer than episode 4.
Thank God we're done soon. And that I genuinely believe that's the kind of the mentality. It's a thank God it's Friday approach.
It's like a sigh of relief.
Yeah. It's like, oh, I've got to go to work on a Friday, but that's okay because tomorrow's Saturday because there is A New Hope.
I've never understood the I've never understood the phrase thank God it's Friday because I've never really had a real job. So
can I explain that to you off mic, bro?
Yeah, that'd be good because you know, I work Sundays sometimes. I work, you know, 2 days a week. Anyway,
my heart bleeds. It really does.
Yeah. I'm not looking for sympathy. I'm just
good.
I'm just showing off.
Now this film is completely written and directed by George Lucas.
Yeah, it completely is.
No Lawrence Kasdan anymore to add interesting
credits.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to ask our guest Jade here this question. What are your thoughts on George Lucas? Not just his directing efforts here in this film, but overall, what are your thoughts towards this man?
Do you know what? He cops a lot of abuse, but I can't feel badly towards him just because of the original trilogy.
Yeah, he's the man who created
Star Wars.
Are there two George Lucases?
Yeah, maybe.
Was there the good one? And this is his evil twin or something?
But he made the original trilogy, so I can't really be too harsh.
Let me ask you this then. What are your favourite Star Wars films in the series?
See, it changes depending what age, depending what part of my life I'm in. Like, as a little kid, I think I liked Return of the Jedi.
Right.
Because it had the Ewoks. Yep. They're right. Pretty awesome.
Not directed by George Lucas.
Correct.
Right. What was the...
Then probably throughout kind of most of my childhood and adolescence, it was probably The Empire Strikes Back because we had it on VHS and we just rewatched it.
Not directed by George Lucas.
Correct. But now my favourite's probably A New Hope.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Okay.
Directed by George Lucas.
Yes. Yeah, okay. Yeah. It's a carry-on for me from his efforts in episode 1 and 2 in this particular one, though. Like, you know, it's a continuity. And, like, you know, he's not any better or worse than he was in episode 1 and 2 in regards to his directing and writing contributions in this one.
The first one's so badly written that I didn't even know what was going on, like, the third or fourth time I watched it.
Yeah.
It just made no sense. It was so inconsistent.
Yeah.
It's interesting with these films because he had a script to start production, but the first script, the shooting script, is not what the films are. And especially in Revenge of the Sith, they talk about it in the special features on the DVD that once he gets to the editing suite, then he starts rewriting the whole show, or the whole movie, and then he goes and reshoots stuff because he has this amazing digital technology. He can just go and shoot James saying 3 lines that can change the whole course of the whole film and put them in with the computer technology wherever he wants to. So there's kind of a sense that he doesn't...
Why didn't he do that? Here are my 3 lines for George Lucas if he had come to me and said, okay, we've done some rewrites. You stand in front of a green screen. Where am I, George? Doesn't matter. Just say the 3 lines. Here are my 3 lines. Ready? Oh, thank God it was all a dream. None of this ever really happened. Okay, bye-bye. And that would be my 3 lines.
Yeah, so there was no complete script. He wrote the script on the go. But continuation of that, as you were just kind of pointing out, a lot of the scenes he'd shoot, and it's like, oh, this is in the hangar at midday, and then in the movie, it's in Palpatine's office at midnight, and then this scene is in the bedroom at 3 a.m., and it's like, oh, and he says this on the commentary all the time. I was like, oh, I'd already done a few scenes in Palpatine's office, so I put this one somewhere else. So then what were you writing? Like, what was the script? And there was no fucking script, was there? Like, there was a weird map of some ideas, and his stunt people were told, oh, we didn't have a script. We're just told that there'd be a fight between these two, and it might be here, but then it ends up being on a fucking Wookiee planet. Like, how do you make a movie this way? How is there consistency? How is there a story arc that you can care about?
But
is this this vague plot point?
How do you act in a movie like how?
Yeah,
you,
well, that's
like,
the other thing.
People talk about,
as
oh,
I
the
said,
wooden acting in Star Wars, and it is wooden.
Terrible.
Yeah. But if you have no context for your performance,
and that's
how
the other thing. Lucas was also saying that he'd take, you know, we'd do a scene together, and he'd take your take 12 and my take 15, and edit those together. It's like, yeah, but I'm responding to his 12, but I'm, you know, like, it doesn't make sense. There's no chemistry. That's why there's no chemistry.
Yeah.
Because
Natalie
whatever.
Portman's a great actor.
She is one of the greatest actors of her generation.
Like,
she's
sucks
brilliant
in these movies because she's not allowed to be a great actor in these movies.
I mean, Hayden Christensen is a fucking shit actor, and he... Actually, don't worry, that's fine.
Yeah, that's fine. We'll put him on the Wookiee planet, even better.
You bring up Natalie Portman, though, James, but... So
I do often, actually, and so, out of context.
But so was Liam Neeson.
Yes?
So is you.
No, no, Lynn, no. Yeah. No.
What?
No to Liam Neeson.
Oh, come on.
He's an average actor.
Oh, he was Oscar Schindler. Come on.
Yes, and he was average. He's an average actor.
Ouch.
He's an average actor. If you make him say less, he's more impressive. He's a very good-looking older man.
I don't know, bro.
You put him in a piece of shit film and he shines. No. This myth that Liam Neeson is actually a fucking actor is bullshit, and I'm here to step on it right now.
All right, here we go.
There are great actors. He's not one of them. He's good. He's a movie star. He's not a great actor.
Okay.
That's a low Nielsen rating.
He was great in Batman Begins, but who's not, and how could you not be? But
he just played the same character.
He played the better character.
He's not a great actor. He's a good actor, and he's a great movie star. But as you were saying, Liam Neeson is a great actor.
Oh,
not
great.
Liam Neeson.
Wow,
Ewan McGregor is a great. Ewan McGregor is a great actor. Natalie Portman's a great actor. Yes. Samuel L. Jackson is very good.
Not in this,
but no, he's not in this.
I feel like in a lot of those movies, they just said, just don't put Ewan McGregor and Natalie Portman together because they'll actually have chemistry.
Yeah,
just keep them apart,
and they do.
Keep them apart. Yeah, they do.
They do.
They do.
And you can see it's like,
problem.
Oh, that's why Anakin's jealous because these guys are really fucking good actors, and you're shit. Like, do I have to be in another scene with them where they make me look wooden?
I don't think Natalie Portman's in a scene with anyone else in this movie, is she? Except Hayden Christensen. It's mostly just her.
Yeah,
in
there's
a room.
The bit at the end.
Oh, at
there's
the
a
end.
Little bit of a little bit of Obi-Wan and Padme action towards the end.
But there's very little.
Because I love how Anakin flies off the handle and gets jealous of those two. There's nothing.
I love that she's not allowed out of her room, and also that she's worried that the Queen won't let her continue working in the Senate if she finds out she's pregnant and has a baby.
Oh, yeah, what's that all about?
I don't know.
Oh, yeah.
And,
but they had to be married because you can't, like, in space. Oh, I can't believe they didn't use this phrase. Oh, thank God we got secretly space married.
In space Vegas.
Oh, space Vegas.
Because otherwise we're going to need a space Mexican divorce. What the hell is that? Oh, we're in space, but we're all Christian.
Well, the last thing you want is for Luke and Leia to be bastards, isn't it?
Yeah,
you've got to, they've got to be married parents.
Force Awakens, Luke's probably a bastard.
The cinematographer again, Bros, is David Tattersall, and I don't mean to be like shitting on David Tattersall, but I just don't like the way these films look, so I just can't. Like,
I don't think it's anything to do with nothing to do with David Tattersall.
No.
In fact, on the making of that I watched on the DVD for this, I don't think David Tattersall's even on it when they're talking when they're shooting.
He's digitally removed.
I think he was. Here's the thing: if you work on a Lucasfilm, you just need to dress in a green suit head to toe and a balaclava, and then you can edit yourself out later. Yeah, but the making of I watched, they had two camera operators, and I don't think either of them. I might be wrong. I don't think either of them were. So I don't know what he. Yeah. I don't know.
It's
not his fault.
It's just a continuity from the first two, really. The look of the film, isn't it?
Like, they do nothing, and it doesn't matter what he shoots because he doesn't get to be a cinematographer because it's all shot on blue screen, or a lot of it shot on blue screen. I don't make generalizations. A lot of it shot on blue screen, and they rescale everything anyway. So if you've got a nice close up of the two of them, and they shot everything in long shots and in full length shots, so they could create their own close ups and wide shots and mid shots and stuff. So they're walking down steps in a nice kind of a nicely framed shot. Then Lucas just blows it all out into a big landscape and puts them as tiny two specks on the steps anyway. So what cinematography is there? George Lucas and his editor are the cinematographer of this film.
Yeah.
Tattersall's just a cinematographer by trade, so that's his credit. Like, it's bullshit.
Jade, what do you think of the look of the... as someone who's a big fan of the original series, where it's all very dirty and...
Yeah.
Right? What do you think of the look of the prequels? Way too clean?
Way too clean.
Yeah.
And I know that they were supposed to be kind of, at the zenith of their...
culture.
Yeah, yeah, their culture. But everything was just too clean and everything was just too CGI and clean and...
You can't be invested in something if you don't believe it's happening.
To be honest, I could have even forgiven the fact that it was too clean if the characters had some kind of...
anything.
If I could connect with any of them in any small way. But I mean, the only person in the entire film that I cared about was R2.
Yeah, I love
R2. And I wonder why that is.
Because he's awesome.
Because he's a great character.
He's the only one that's got any character.
Well, his delivery was very good.
When he was hiding when they went to rescue Palpatine at the very beginning and he was, being chased by the robots and he was hiding next to those little cylinders, I was terrified. That was my only moment of fear in the whole film.
Your only connection.
Yeah, my only connection. I was like, no, don't let Archie get hurt.
Yeah.
They've got to get a better system, don't they?
Yeah.
Then those little communicators that they have. Why does a robot need a communicator anyway? It should be built in.
I never understood why all the robots...
You're basically going to get your droid killed. Just shut your mouth, Obi-Wan. Why do you keep talking? If he's not responding, he's probably in trouble. Just don't kill R2.
By the way, aren't you a Jedi? Shouldn't you know this shit? You're not Superman. Lead doesn't stop you. Why can't you just see what
just
the hell is
happening?
Just force
it. And God forbid if you're an R2 style droid in that universe, you're fucked, aren't you? Yeah. How many of those droids get killed in this film?
And it's R2 and C-3PO meant to be in the new one?
Yeah, they are. I believe. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Jade loves it.
I love R2.
In the world's oldest droid. R2 must be 100 years old by now. Hasn't he been replaced?
No, we don't replace a robot with the Force.
Jesus.
In the commentary, I watched the commentary, obviously, for this awesome moment, which you would have just lost your shit. At one point, I think it's on the volcano planet at the end there, the guy that, one of the CGI artists, is talking about how he put a lot of dust and dirt and soot and smoke and stuff into that scene, and Lucas said, it's too dirty.
No.
It's too dirty.
No.
So every time he worked on those sequences, he was worried about overdoing it, because he was like, I love it when it's gritty and dirty and, it's got this real tangible kind of realistic feel to it. And he goes, but the whole time I'm just worried Lucas is going to say, no, it's too dirty. And so he got away with a little bit, but not much. But that gives you the idea of the philosophy behind these films and perfectly sums up, what you've been saying the whole time. That everything's too clean and crisp.
Well, can I just say, on the cinematography, it makes sense that the guy who did it is called Tattersall's because every shot's a lottery.
Hey!
I've been sitting on that for 10 minutes.
Get out.
Dollar.
Trying to get that out. That will be edited out.
Keep it.
Well, let's talk about the cast then, shall we? Yeah. Ewan McGregor, Obi-Wan Kenobi.
I don't think we'll be spending a lot of time here because I think we've said...
No, we have. But let's just talk about them in this particular film, maybe in comparison to the first two then. Well, Ewan McGregor.
Continuing Brose. The theme, right? This is Ewan McGregor's least worst performance in the prequels.
Correct.
Yep.
He finally seems a little bit more confident in being this hybrid between himself and Alec Guinness. He enunciates a little too often for my liking, but he's good in this. He's better than he has been, I should say.
I agree. I think the beard's doing a lot of the heavy lifting.
Oh, yeah. And that stroking of the beard, isn't it? Just a beautiful little beard stroke every now and then.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think he gets probably the best acting moment in the entire prequel trilogy, I think. And that's the moment when Anakin's burnt on the, next to the lava, and he just, yells down at him,
"You are the chosen one! It was said that you would destroy the Sith, not join them! Bring balance to the Force! Not leave it in darkness!" My brother, Anakin! I loved you!
I like that Anakin yells at him, "I hate you," and he says, "I love you, you are my brother." I thought, okay.
Yeah, but I mean, probably the best acting moment in the prequel trilogy.
Yeah.
And we just have to pick out this tiny, 10-second snippet.
I almost cared about Ewan McGregor in this, in this film.
Yeah, almost.
Yeah. Almost.
I think that would describe Ewan McGregor's career. I think we're all on the verge of almost caring about Ewan McGregor in almost everything.
I almost care.
Natalie Portman plays Padme.
At no point in these films does she get her groove. At no point does she...
Well, she's not allowed to, though.
No. I mean, she never had a mission. Leia always had a mission in every episode. Yeah. She actually had something to do. She's trying to achieve something.
Not allowed to leave her room, really.
Yeah. Well, she's barefoot and pregnant for this whole movie. Yeah. Like, it's awful.
I know. And the whole time, I think it's also telling the way that every time she's ever referred to, she's referred to as Natalie Portman, never, Senator Amidala or, when you're talking about her.
Yep.
Brose, just thoughts on Hayden Christensen as Anakin Skywalker, because we really covered him pretty well on Attack of the Clones.
And then talk about Liam Neeson again.
Just replay what he said before.
Here's the thing. I've kind of been defending Hayden Christensen, at least in my own mind, not out loud, up until this film. And in this film, it's just... And it's not... it's not entirely his fault. Anakin's so badly written. It's such a bad story arc. It's so overplayed. It's so obvious. We know where he's going to end up. It's fucking Darth Vader, George. But he doesn't help the cause. He might be trying his best to dig something out of the script to give a performance, but he's not good enough.
But Hayden Christensen gets a much better emotional journey on this film than ever before.
Oh, true.
And he gets better dialogue. He gets more screen time. I agree. He sunk in Attack of the Clones with some terrible everything.
Yeah.
But in this film, as I said, I really love the idea because I'd never seen this before. I am watching it from the point of view of, okay, well, what is the plot of this thing? And the idea that the Jedi push Hayden Christensen towards the dark side by making him a spy is a really lovely idea. That's a cool idea. And then Hayden Christensen is torn between, okay, well, I like this Chancellor guy. He's getting shit done, and he knows some dark arts, and I've had a... I want to save my wife, and this dark arts thing might help me, but I'm also, I have loyalty to the Jedi and particularly Obi-Wan. That's something that you could play well.
Could.
Yeah, it was.
If you had a chance.
It was supposed to be, Anakin Skywalker's story was supposed to be a great tragedy, and it just wasn't in this film.
Well, his turn is supremely rushed.
Yeah. Well, I just find all the connecting dots, all the connections aren't that tight. And him and Padme and him and Obi-Wan, you don't care enough about those three relationships in the first place for the big twist to mean anything.
Yeah.
We had three episodes to see an interesting story about the turn.
Yeah.
They take about a minute of this film and then bang.
Well, the other thing too is because in Attack of the Clones, they fuck up the Obi-Wan Anakin relationship so much. And he's such a whiny, angry little shit throughout that whole film that Lucas is then desperate at the start of this film to say, no, they're buddies. They're buddies. They're good buddies. They get along. They joke. Yeah. They laugh. They're buddies. Look, see, this 2 minutes of film out of 2 hours proves they're buddies. Now I can forget it. And it's just not enough. There's not enough chemistry. There's not enough going on between them for you to care about their relationship enough for him to okay, so we know he's going to turn, so we're not, like, there's no one cares.
Well, the problem is, because obviously it's got to be written with the fact that a lot of people know the ultimate ending in mind already because they've seen A New Hope. So, I agree. The problem is there's just time after time spent on boring, long exposition scenes about nothing. And then at the end, we get 5 minutes of, and then he's Darth Vader. And then there's a Death Star. The end. And you're just like, guess.
They're all afterthoughts. Then, they're done.
And so, by the way, that Death Star at the end looks like it's, that's
getting
pretty close, isn't
it's
it?
Getting,
how much longer is that going to take to build? Because
10 years.
It has to take at least 20 because Luke's got to be...
17 or 19?
It's something like that.
Jade, we said in the... I personally said in the Attack of the Clones episode that I thought that Hayden Christensen in that film... which carries on to this one, is one of the worst performances I've seen in what would be described as an A-grade movie, which, you know, a film called Star Wars would be.
You'd hope.
What do you think? What do you think of Hayden Christensen in this series?
I would like to have an opinion, but I don't even think I care enough to have one.
Okay. Mm. That pretty much sums it up for me then, you know?
Like... Can we talk some more about Liam Neeson? Is he in this film?
That's enough, bro.
Well, quickly then, bros. Ian McDiarmid.
He's all right in this.
Palpatine.
He's the best
He's one of the saving graces of these films. Yeah.
The whole trilogy, he's the best thing.
He's consistent. His performance is consistent and he's menacing and he's... The only problem I have with Palpatine the whole time is... It's just so obvious that he's Sidious.
Yeah.
And I don't know if that's supposed to be a twist. There's no suspense there.
Yeah.
The fact that it really frustrates me when he's got his hood on in those holograms talking to one of his minions. They're like, you reckon this guy looks a bit like Senator Palpatine, is it? Supreme Chat? Is that? No, it's Darth Sidious. No, but doesn't it look just a little... No, come with me here. Don't you think it looks a little bit like this? And there's like, no one ever picks it up.
You would have liked a scene where some random guy's going, hey, you know you've got a doppelganger?
Yeah, exactly.
That's really weird.
So on Doppelganger Day on Facebook, do you put up Palpatine? It's just annoying.
It just makes it much less believable that the Jedi are really that wise.
Yeah, they don't seem wise
right
at all.
Right there under their nose. And in the last film, someone said, Darth Sidious has taken control of the Senate. And they're like, oh, this Palpatine guy's a bit dodgy. I don't really trust him.
I think there is a line in there where he's saying he uses the Sith powers to muddy the thinking.
Yeah, but even without the Force... He's right in front of them.
Yeah.
His own minion told them he was there.
Yeah. So it's just...
By the way, the Jedi... By the way, the Jedi are betrayed and destroyed by their own clone army. Jedi see that coming?
No, apparently not.
Don't see into the future,
apparently. No, don't understand
the thing. And that's the problem.
The Force is very...
A lot of inconsistency with the Force.
And midichlorians are mentioned again.
I know.
To the detriment of the entire series.
Yeah. Yeah. Samuel Jackson.
Sam Jackson's back.
It's
Mace Windu.
Mace Windu.
He gets his big finale scene, doesn't he, this time?
He's got a point of being there.
He does.
I'll into that a little bit later. As well,
looking
James, about
fabulous.
What that is actually all about as well, because there's a couple of fan theories as to like exactly what goes on there
in regards
to his appearance.
Is.
But
I'll bet there is.
But any other thoughts on Sam Jackson?
Oh no, Sam Jackson, move on, doesn't matter.
Supporting cast.
Jimmy Smith, doesn't matter. Frank Oz, I think, again, turns out another really good performance.
His voice works. Yoda.
Digital Yoda's shits me to tears. But Frank Oz is consistent again. He's always quite sturdy.
Peter Mayhew makes a little appearance again as Chewbacca.
A bizarre, pointless... You know that scene where Yoda's climbing into his little pod there to fly off? That was a reshoot, and Lucas put it in there so that he could reinforce that that was Chewbacca. It's like, does it matter if that's Chewbacca or not?
Like, and why is Chewbacca there? Like, and what is Chewbacca's story? How does he end up just working with a dick like Han Solo? Yeah. Like, what's going? If he seems to be high up in the Wookiee,
he does.
Community.
Well, he seems to be second in charge.
Second
he?
In charge.
There's the king guy there, and then Chewbacca's next to him.
So although we are going to get a Han Solo movie, maybe it will explain that.
Yeah,
but
I mean that's a more interesting story. But.
Who's going to play Han Solo?
In the new movie?
I'm worried about that.
I'm really worried about that. Because I tried to relive my Han Solo love through Firefly.
Yeah.
But
it doesn't work.
I think it'll be Hayden Christensen.
I'm hoping and praying.
I've heard
it's Hayden Christensen.
Liam Neeson. I've heard it's Liam Neeson. He's a great actor.
Liam Neeson's playing the old Han
Solo.
He
can do anything. Oh, another quick special mention. Teon Medon is played by Bruce Spence, who we've talked about in the Mad Max films. And I love Bruce Spence.
He's also in the Matrix trilogy.
There you go.
He
shows up. I love Bruce Spence in anything. So
yeah, me too.
It was nice. And just that moment when he pops up, you're like, hello. Bruce Spence.
Yeah. With teeth slightly more believable than his actual teeth.
That is true.
Do you guys have a favourite scene in Revenge of the Sith?
I do, actually. I really liked the fact in Attack of the Clones they had where they introduced Grievous. I didn't mind Grievous, or as I'm going to call him, Ultron, in this movie. I didn't mind him. He was an okay bad guy. But I really liked how at the there was a scene in Attack of the Clones that didn't mean anything, where he put the lightsaber of the Jedi in his robe. Like, he collects the lightsaber of the Jedi. Mm. And then the scene where he opens his robe, he's got four lightsabers and four hands. And I went, finally, a Jedi is facing someone who, like, the Jedi's the underdog in this scene, because that guy's got four lightsabers. And I went, great, finally, I'm watching a scene and I'm barracking for the right guy in this scene. I thought that that lightsaber fight with the four, I thought that was pretty cool.
I didn't realise Grievous is an alien with a robot exoskeleton the first time I saw this. It wasn't until I watched the commentary that it's kind of explained.
Well, because he's coughing.
Yeah, he's coughing. Well, I never understood
robot.
Yeah. Yeah, but he's not a robot. He's like 20-30% alien and then 70% robot. Not explained. Yeah. But once that was explained to me, like, oh, that's kind of cool, because the cough is so... doesn't mean...
But it doesn't make any sense. I guess you notice when he gets killed how, like, his organic parts burn.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
That's when I noticed. But then it would have been nice to know that at the beginning of the fight.
Did you guys notice as well about the... this is the only film where the lightsabers have been changed a little bit? They're, like, more pointy at the end? Did you guys realise that?
Oh, really? Yeah.
Like, what's that all about?
I didn't notice. I don't care.
I don't know.
But why would you change that in the sixth film as well?
Because, like, you could...
They're trying to just show that they're... I don't know. They've progressed or something.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Well, it doesn't make any sense, because at the end, like, literally Obi-Wan makes a point of taking Anakin's lightsaber.
Yeah.
So you know that's the lightsaber he used to Luke.
Yeah,
is
that's
it pointy
true.
In A New Hope? Well, then it can't be the same lightsaber, can it?
Well, here's something else for you. That moment where Obi-Wan turns around, bends down and picks up his lightsaber and walks off, reshoots.
Forgot that was part of his own mythology?
Yeah.
Because he's not a fan. I told you, George Lucas doesn't know anything about these movies.
He doesn't. He has
watched
no idea.
Them a couple of times.
Yeah.
But not, like, obsessively. Like,
did you see the interview during the week where someone said, oh, so George, after 10 years, what do you think of Hayden Christensen in Revenge of the Sith?
Who?
He said, Hayden Christensen in it?
Oh, he did.
Is he in it?
Wow.
No, he didn't say it. He didn't.
Went in on a 10-minute diatribe against Liam Neeson, apparently.
Favourite scene, Jade?
I don't have a favourite scene for this. I really... struggled my way through this film.
You know what my two answers to the previous films were? Phantom Menace, end of the end credits, they play Darth Vader's breathing, like the moment of the film.
Yeah.
Attack of the Clones, couldn't find one. Yeah,
I mean,
actually,
I
at the end of Phantom Menace, that's my breathing. I'm just...
It's a collective sigh from all Star Wars fans.
I thought the fight scene at the end was okay, and
but it goes on though.
I know, it goes on way too much, and you know what the outcome's going to be for all of those fights.
There's no tension.
There's no tension because you know how the story ends.
Yeah.
You know that the Emperor and Yoda are both going to be alive in the next trilogy, and you know that Anakin's going to be Darth Vader.
Yep.
And you know that Obi-Wan is not going to be killed.
Yep.
So the fight scenes only need to be about 3 seconds long.
That is one of the biggest problems with this film and the prequels in general. Every fight scene is irrelevant because it doesn't matter who wins.
Yeah.
Because we know who needs to win that fight. So doesn't matter. The Obi-Wan, Anakin, doesn't matter.
And you also know, like, on the flip side of that is you also know when you see someone like Qui-Gon Jinn, you go, well, he's probably going to die because he's not in,
Master
doesn't make
Windu.
It.
You
just know. You know that anyone who's not in those first three movies ain't going to make it.
So the other thing I was going to say earlier with George Lucas's other problem with these films, beside trying to fill the frame with every 5 seconds, is his need to over-explain everything, which we've talked about already. That being said, one of my favourite moments in this film is... when Yoda says to Obi-Wan at the end, I'll teach you how to communicate with Qui-Gon Jinn in the afterlife or whatever, that little moment, I quite liked that.
I didn't like the way it was done. That felt like lip service. It's just like, oh, and also...
A lot of that stuff is lip service because it's Lucas just going through, I'll explain that. But that little moment, I just liked that moment between Yoda and Obi-Wan. I thought it was kind of nice.
Imagine if he'd showed him that instead of told him. And that's George Lucas.
Well, that's what you're saying about clones.
Imagine if he had conjured up Qui-Gon Jinn as a spirit at the end, and you go, like they do at the Return of the Jedi, and you go, oh, okay, that's cool, I see where that comes from. No, just one character telling another character
Same
way, hey honey, I just slaughtered a whole bunch of fucking sand people. Did you show it? Nah, didn't.
Or the children.
Or the children.
I wanted to hate him. You want to hate Anakin, but
they don't show you enough.
You know that you're supposed to.
Yeah,
but that's the whole thing. Like that. All of those prequels are just telling the shit out of the backstory.
We all hate him. Yeah. We all hate him.
But for the wrong reasons.
True. I love the idea of Star Wars, the prequels, is just telling the shit out of the backstory.
Yeah.
I think that's right.
Adam, your anger will lead to hate and your hate will lead to the dark side.
Exactly.
So calm down. I have got the worst moment in the whole film.
Better than the best moment.
The worst moment for me in the whole film.
That's really tough.
And no. This is
too many favorites.
This is horrible, right?
Okay.
Good, good. The Force is strong with you, Anakin Skywalker. A powerful Sith you will become. Henceforth, you shall be known as Darth...
What's a good name? What's a good name?
Vader! Darth Vader! Darth Vader! Dark Laser! Deathwater! Ralph Nader! Fuck!
We didn't start the fire.
Get up, Darth. Like, it's just dumb. It's so dumb. Where does it come from? What is he... What? Where does... What? Darth, where does he pull that from? You'll be Darth... Vader. It's just...
I didn't know that, because that's kind of how they announce a new pope. What name would you like as a pope? John Paul George Ringo. Like, it doesn't matter.
Oh, it's so, so
bad. Maybe George Lucas was hoping to make another trilogy of prequels to the prequels where he further explains all of the backstory to the backstory.
But just quickly, where does Sidious get the name from? Like, where does Vader come from? Is it a name he's been carrying around for a while? There's fan theories that he pulled it from the Dark Force, that pause that he has there isn't him going, it's him going, searching the Force for Vader.
Trying to remember his line.
I'll tell you where it came from, bros. It's called Star Wars Episode 4, A New Hope.
Yeah.
That's where he got it from.
He'd seen it.
He pulled it from the future. Yeah.
That's a good name. If I ever have to name a
Sith Lord.
It's bizarre. It's just, I did a bit of research on Darth Vader. We haven't looked at Darth Vader's name at all.
Not his name.
No. So it's interesting because there's different theories where it came from. But one of the theories behind Darth is that it's a combination of Dark Sith.
Makes sense.
So that you're a Dark Sith Vader and Dark Sith Vader.
I like Darth it's like a title, like Sir or Lord.
But in A New Hope, Darth.
It's nice.
Obi-Wan refers to Darth just as Darth, as if it's his proper name, not as a title.
Because he says Lord Vader.
Yeah, and he says, if you have a chat to Darth. So there's a chance
chat to Darth.
Because Lucas didn't... Darth Vader wasn't necessary, because Dark Father is also what it's been translated as. But in A New Hope, he wasn't Luke's father yet. It wasn't until the second one that he kind of decided that he was going to be the father.
Yep.
So Dark Father doesn't work as his real name. The other theory, which I really like, is that Vader is short for Invader,
yes.
As Sidious is short for Insidious. And that's kind of nice as well, like in terms of the where Lucas got it from.
I assume that's what it was.
There's Darth Maul, Darth Tyrannus, Darth Sidious, Darth Vader, yeah.
Of all the things that Lucas thought would be really good, they just don't seem to surface here. He was too busy trying to tie up how this stuff happened and not what would be really compelling to tell us all, you know, in the audience as an actual story. And weak draft-like scripts... No one went over the scripts and said, this needs tightening up. Why does this happen? What's going on here? It all boils down, James, to yes men. We can level all of our wrath at Lucas, but it took a lot of people not challenging him along the way to fuck these movies quite as hard as he managed to. He's not a talented writer or director. He's a great producer, a great creator. He gets shit done, and boy, does he create some iconic characters that we all know and love. But he needed to collaborate with a team of 200 or so Lucasfilm artists. But Lucas needed Rick McCallum or even his old mate Spielberg to tell him firmly that what he was putting on screen had potential and flashes of excellence, let down by gigantic piles of garbage. And after the first prequel peak fuck that it was... When it was released and evidence was out there that things were not right with this process, the shared delusion that whatever they were doing was good enough had years to be addressed.
I don't think that's fair.
Why?
I don't think that's fair. George Lucas is the super ego here. He's the guy in charge, and he's the guy. It's not about whether, if I'm one of the CGI guys, it's not about me making something that I like. That's not my job. My job is to make something my boss likes. So all I'm doing the whole time is trying to get the approval of my boss, who, by the way, pays my bills. So it's not about me delivering subpar work in terms of the whole realm of the existence of cinema. It's about me delivering work that my boss likes. And that comment I made earlier about the volcanic ash and smoke and stuff, I as an artist want more dust and dirt and grit, but my boss doesn't want that. So I'm living under the shadow the entire time. And not only that, it's, you know, there's maybe four people between me and George Lucas anyway. And so you're not just dealing with George Lucas, but you're dealing with a hierarchy of people that want to deliver something to Lucas that he's happy with at the risk of me losing my job.
But that's the problem, is that if you take that analogy further, a lot of films aren't run by a boss. They're run by a board of directors.
Yeah, yeah. Well, they are now, yeah.
That's right. So, and the problem with
which is what's going to dig Marvel's hole. Marvel's hole will be dug by that committee of filmmaking, which is not the way it should be. But, well, I mean,
but then
Spielberg,
you can't have it both ways. George Lucas is put in charge of something that is definitely his, and he completely screws it up.
Spielberg contributed to the final battle. That final sword fight on the volcano planet, Spielberg contributed to. His ideas are used. And Lucas talks about how, you know, I didn't want to do this, but Spielberg really thought it'd be good if I did this type of shot. And that shot is in there. So Spielberg, his hands are on that scene, and it doesn't make it any better.
Oh, it's gone.
But at the end of the day, Lucas is still Lucas is still he's telling Spielberg what to do.
But like, that's like adding a pinch of salt to a lake of cyanide. Like by then, it's too late.
Yeah,
it's,
it tastes delicious. I don't think it's fair to attack anybody that worked on these films under Lucas, because that's harsh. Especially if there were Australian CGI companies that worked on it, and Australian people that are just. You know, the industry is so delicate here that if you've got an American production here, you're going to do everything they want you to do. You're going to be subservient to them because they're the great gods from Hollywood.
I just don't think anyone stood up to him in this.
I've worked on a lot of bad TV shows in this country.
Why'd you look at me when you said that?
No.
I've worked on some TV shows with you. What's that?
I've worked on bad shows. And I can tell you, I worked my ass off. I did the best job I could. And I knew it was a sinking ship, and I knew the show wasn't any good. These are shows I've worked behind the scenes on, by the way, not shows I've appeared in.
And certainly not shows you're currently working on.
No,
right?
Definitely not.
Okay, good.
But I've worked on, I worked on a really bad chat panel show for Channel 7. It was awful. It was awful from the start. I was a writer and I did audience warm-up for them. There was nothing I could do, but all I wanted to do was please the producer because he was the guy paying my bills.
The thing I don't understand is that The Phantom Menace was such a shambles. And it came out so many years before, and then Attack of the Clones wasn't really much better. Surely he picked up the vibe that everyone thought his films were awful.
I think George was living in a bubble. Yeah. I think he was in this little 6 to 8 year Star Wars bubble that he put himself in and didn't have time to come up for air. I don't think, because that's the problem with back-to-back films. The other thing too, remember, he self-financed these films, so he really is the last word on them. But yeah, I mean, he was in a little Star Wars bubble. He's wrong. Lucas was wrong, at least as far as Star Wars fans are concerned. But I don't know.
But it's also that thing too of the internet.
I wouldn't be blaming it down the line.
In 1999, 2000, when the first of the films come out.
That's
now, sure. And probably by 2005, when the last one comes out. And that's when Lucas went, they don't like me. Oh, I'm not going to make it anymore. But before that, there isn't, like, there is public outcry, but it isn't as, you know, internetized.
Accessible to him.
Do you think Lucas learnt anything from the first two films going into this third one? Do you think there's any evidence in this film that he went, okay, I'll fix that up and I'll fix this up?
There was slightly more plot.
There was, but is that also because he had a certain story to tell and told 10%
of it
in the first two films and the 90%.
Is that just a happy accident?
I said to Adam this morning when he came, it's like, this is the only prequel. Okay, you don't need to watch any prequels, but this is the only one you should watch. This is all that matters. In terms of all the bullshit that goes into the three prequels, you could just watch this one and not be completely...
Yeah, you don't have to watch
it. If you watch this one, doesn't it ruin the greatest cinematic reveal in...
True.
For
yes.
all of the cinematic
True.
Reveals
yep.
in the
True.
Actual old original
yep.
trilogy?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
I was thinking if you were kind of... If you watched everything sequentially, like chronologically 1 to 6, the prequels, A, they're awful...
Mm.
And B, they kind of ruin all the exciting reveals in the original trilogy.
Yeah, true. Yep. True. Yeah, they're useless. But yeah. The prequels are useless.
But, so at the very end, Padme's dying because she's lost the will to live.
I think it's a hair transplant gone bad.
I mean, so much issue with this.
That's so bad.
They're in space. They can bring Anakin back after he's been burnt by lava and all of his limbs chopped off. But no one's running around trying to save Padme when she died in childbirth.
She has to die because it was said so in the
But do you know what was also said in Return of the Jedi when Luke says, "Leia, do you remember your mother?" And she says, "Oh, I remember a little bit. Mostly just feelings. She was really beautiful." And
I think that's her adopted mother she's talking about.
No, it's supposed to be her real mother.
No, it's supposed to be.
Well, that doesn't make
any
sense.
No, it doesn't. It is supposed to be because they're talking about being brother and sister.
Oh, well, that makes no sense at all.
Those 5 seconds as she died as I was lifted up to see her.
She died of a broken heart. Apparently.
I remember being sad because she was dying because I killed her. Is that what Leia is saying? Like, she was sad because childbirth killed her or sadness killed her or something.
You start off with this reasonably strong female politician in The Phantom Menace, right?
We're told she is.
Yeah.
She doesn't really
do much.
We
don't see any evidence.
No, that's true. Even in Clone, she's out there sort of fighting one-handed, right?
Yeah.
You end her arc.
She kicks a little bit of ass in Attack of
This is what they do. you end her arc because her man has turned to the dark side and killing little Jedi kids. She no longer has the will to live for her own children that are in her belly.
Yeah.
Yep.
So she's going to abandon her kids because of Anakin. Bullshit.
It's bullshit.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's bullshit.
There is no explanation that can possibly rationalize that. Why not just have
no one can choose to die? Why not just have Anakin told to by bad
just have Anakin
well,
to force something on top of her?
There is a medical condition called Takotsubo's, which is supposedly the disease of a broken heart.
Hello, doctor.
So, yeah, hello.
Hello,
so you came in and brought you just twisted and brought facts to the story.
But that is the most absurd way to close down a character.
It is ridiculous.
Yeah, and
unheroic.
I took a lot of issue with the fact that they're like, oh yeah, she's dying, and no one's running around trying to do anything.
Do you know why she dies? Because she has to.
Yeah, yeah, of course she does. Yeah,
that's why she dies.
Padme, plot device, Amidala.
Yeah, but why couldn't Anakin be more responsible for her death? Like, he could throw something on her, he could stab her by accident.
He could have killed her.
He could have killed her.
He could get out of that. Why didn't he just do that?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, why? Like, that's Lucas's decision to say, broken heart, we'll do that, broken heart.
Yeah, did it ever occur to Lucas that the sight of your newborn healthy babies might just mend a broken heart really fucking fast?
Yeah, they would.
You know?
Children are supposed to heal all, aren't they? They save marriages.
Yeah, it's the...
oh dear.
It's the final nail in the coffin of her weakness, though.
Like, no pun intended. Like, but, Leia suffers the same fate. In the original trilogy, we start with this amazing, intelligent, and aggressive, and brilliant
sassy woman.
And by the third film, by Jedi, she's a mum, and she kind of does nothing.
Like, that's not true. Look, she has a cool opening scene in Jedi where she goes undercover to save Han Solo, and she saves Han Solo.
Yeah,
that's
pretty
sweet. That's empowering, I think. Yeah. I like that moment.
But that's revealed to be all part of Luke's plan.
Yeah,
all of that is all that serendipity is all Luke's plan, apparently. So she's no longer
strangles
the leader.
Jabba the Hutt.
Yeah,
that's pretty awesome. But later on, with
come on, don't be too harsh.
I'm just saying.
No, I'm just saying that she goes from
and she saves Han Solo's life at the door
on Hoth. On Hoth, she is in charge. She is the boss. People are coming up to her and asking her questions. And then at the end of Jedi, when they're in the Rebel ship, everyone else is telling her what to do all of a sudden. It's like, well, but hang on. She was your leader. She was the one to look up to. She's one of the great Rebel survivors and a great story for the Rebel Alliance.
Mm.
And then Lucas just subjugates her and on Endor, she's Wicket's mum. She is.
Now, just before I get you guys your thoughts on the Darth Vader... I just want to lead up to that, okay? So we get to see Anakin being put in the Vader suit and being told that, Padme's dead. And this is the best moment in the prequels because Vader is born before our eyes.
Lord Vader, can you hear me?
Yes, Master. Where is Padme? Is she safe? Is she all right?
It seems in your anger, you killed her.
I couldn't have. She was alive. I felt it.
The next few seconds are so crucial. At this point, he's lost his limbs, his looks, and with creepy robotic limbs and breathing apparatus grafted onto his hideously burnt torso and head, this is enough of a horrific situation to drive most people insane. But remember, this is also a man who has lost everything. His position on the Jedi Council, the friendship of his master, his wife, and his unborn child. Let's face it, he's lost his soul. This is the utter breaking of a man, the shattering of dreams and potential, leaving a horrendous mechanical wraith. The closest possible moment I could think of is Michael Corleone at the end of Godfather 3. Now, just before you bag Godfather 3, because...
I haven't seen it.
I don't mind Godfather. No, it's not that bad.
Just before we bag that film, right?
It's Scarface line.
I'm just pointing to a particular part in that film, right? So his daughter is killed in front of him as a direct result of who he is and what he's done, right? Her blood is on his hands. The immensity of a lifetime of good intentions and bad deeds comes crashing down on top of him, and he falls to his knees and screams in utter anguish and despair. It's Al Pacino too, of course, and he can somehow out-act Hayden Christensen. But it's the deepingly powerful finale to an otherwise disappointing third film. Something like that, with a full-throated roar from James Earl Jones mixed in with the screechy mechanics of his new body, a shiver would have leapt down the spines of every person in the audience. It's as if he'd just, fallen to the floor and screamed.
Yeah.
Right? Like, you know, with that, with, you know, Vader, yeah. Something we haven't seen Vader do, yeah. right? And the legend would have been born, like, right there, right? And then you would have understood, like, you know, why but, Vader yeah. is, other, right? What happens in Sith is Vader stumbles forward like Frankenstein's monster and shouts, yeah. No! While the camera pans back on a crane like a made-for-television action movie. It's an epic fail of, yeah. like, what is the, a crucial...
That was Lucas's decision was that Vader would be like... You know, it's that Frankenstein's monster's moment. That's exactly what he wanted. He wanted it to look like Frankenstein coming up from the table and yeah. stumbling around, and it weakens the character. The other thing is, why doesn't Anakin, as Vader, turn on Sidious at least for a moment? Because Sidious has put him in that position, and surely he's smart enough to realize that. Surely he's smart enough to... I mean, Sidious would obviously be able to talk him down and stop him from killing him or whatever, but wouldn't that be his first response? Wouldn't he? It's like, you know, you killed Padme. It's like, no, actually, Sidious, you killed Padme, so I'm going to destroy you. You're like, just... It's just shit.
I think he was just racked with guilt, so he was kind of thinking more internally. But I don't know. I don't know what
anything would have been better than that.
I think the film could have ended there, though. Just before that, when they put the mask on, yeah, he was breathing. Yeah. That would have been the best place to end the film.
If you cut that few seconds out of him stumbling and knowing, that'd be the just that's it.
End it with Emma,
that's already more tense and exciting.
It's also really disconcerting as well, because you know, well, the behind the scenes tell you that you actually know that that's Hayden Christensen inside
in the suit. I know you hate that. You hate it.
Yeah, but he's burned beyond recognition. Fine.
Yeah.
I'm going to buy you the Revenge of the Sith Hayden Christensen 12-inch Hot Toys figure. Just so that you know when you look at that Vader toy that
Bruce, you've been...
The other thing, too, is Hayden Christensen... Vader should never fold his arms, either.
No.
Darth Vader does not fold his arms.
He might accidentally press one of the useless buttons on his chest. And then, oh, ejector seat!
Bruce, you've been through this now Star Wars series...
Six films.
Me, right? So you know that, like, I'm a fan of the character of Vader, Darth Vader and how much I can't stand Anakin. So, you know, so it's just this combination of the two that, yeah, it just simply doesn't work for me. And isn't he also too young as well?
Far too young at this point. Because how old is Anakin in Jedi? He's like 60 or something.
Yeah.
60, 65.
Well, until he's replaced in the final scene by of Return of the Jedi with Hayden Christensen. Which was, I actually, when I saw that version on DVD, I think I yelled, no!
Yeah.
Wasn't very convincing, though. So, you know, it was on point.
Yeah.
It's awful.
It's a subtitle for this film, really, isn't it? So, anyway, just quickly, guys, why does Sidious's appearance change as well in the confrontation with Sam Jackson?
When he becomes the Emperor we know and love, because his lightning gets on him?
While the most common explanation is that there was deflection of his own Force lightning, originally directed at Mace Windu, which caused Sidious's facial deformity, the true reason is that Sidious had disguised himself and the Sith lightning merely melted it away, revealing his true self.
Well, that was obvious.
This is backed by printed literature from around the time that Return of the Jedi came out, stating that...
Is this non-canon or is this canon?
Not sure. Not sure. But around the time that Return of the Jedi came out, stating that the Emperor's body and features had been nulled over time by his extended use of the dark side of the Force. While both Anakin in Attack of the Clones and Luke in Return of the Jedi both suffer Force lightning being aimed at them, neither of them are left physically scarred by the incident. However, Anakin was only hit briefly by Count Dooku's Force lightning, and it may well have been that the Emperor did not intend to kill Luke immediately, wanting his death to be slow and painful as he gloated over him.
Well, here's my question, right? So, I don't mind it. Prolonged use of the dark side of the Force makes your face wrinkly. It's not a Nivea
That's
commercial.
That's what happened to Mark Hamill.
Yes. But it makes sense. I'm okay with that. But then why at the end doesn't he just go back to using the makeup again? Why is he now suddenly scarred for life? He's been using something to cover the terribleness. Okay, well, why can't he just go back to doing that?
Because now he's the intergalactic emperor and he doesn't have to.
Because it's not like
he's
that
not impressing
in the,
anybody
in the second movie.
Exactly.
The makeup design looks like a cheap rubber mask. Yeah. It's not that convincing. It's kind of frustrating. Part of it is CGI, that face, in different points too, which is no fucking surprise here.
No, definitely not.
What CGI in the prequels?
I know! so unexpected.
A little bit of trivia here from Revenge of the Sith. Originally, a young Han Solo was going to make an appearance in this film, living among the Wookiees.
Oh, thank God that didn't happen.
Also played by Hayden Christensen.
Oh, would have been amazing.
Yeah, it would have been great.
The volcanic world of Mustafa, I think is how you pronounce it.
Mufasa. No.
Yeah. Is that... Yeah. James L. Jones.
That's what I kept thinking every time they said it was Mustafa.
It is the circle of life.
Yeah.
That's unbelievable.
It was designed to look like George Lucas's vision of hell.
Just the vision of hell, aren't they?
All the Star Wars fans around the world's
and
vision of
George
hell.
George Lucas is the yeah. devil.
George Lucas deliberately made the Darth Vader suit top heavy, for instance, adding weight on the helmet to make Hayden Christensen not appear too accustomed to it in the movie.
Wow, it's that eye for detail that who cares?
Oh, just a quick note. As bad as it is having Hayden Christensen in the suit, the CGI guys on the commentary mentioned that they thought they were going to have to animate Vader. So is it better to have Hayden Christensen in there, or would it have been better to have animated based on Prowse's movements from the previous films?
Oh, I don't know. Yeah.
Yeah, because none of the animated characters work ever in these films, ever. Do they look convincing or good? But yeah, that was the other option. So it's
I think George Lucas made a lot of them top-heavy, though. So. Blah, 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 who cares?
Apart from providing the voice of R2-D2 and the heavy breathing of Darth Vader, which he has done since Star Wars Episode 4 A New Hope...
Ben Burtt.
Yay!
...provide the voices for every battle droid, super battle droid, and buzz droid in Revenge of the Sith.
I don't know why they needed to speak. Couldn't they just be, like, linked to each other through some kind of network? They're robots.
But then they don't get to say Roger, Roger in that annoying way.
Roger, Roger.
Oh, God. Yes.
Why are they all called Roger?
I'm just trying to work out a way of getting the good old Ben Burtt in there.
Roger, 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 Roger.
Present.
Roger.
There are over 2,200 visual effects shots in the film, more than Star Wars Episode 1, The Phantom Menace, and Star Wars Episode 2, Attack of the Clones combined.
Yeah. Oh, that's why it's a much better film.
More CGI, George, more!
To put it in context, yeah, New Hope had 350. Yeah. So, yeah. Palpatine's lightsaber fight with the other Jedi reveals a completely different technique than has been seen before. The Chancellor uses his weapon like a fencing foil, striking with the tip. Since the beam cuts through any substance, this makes even a small strike a killing blow. Except for Mace Windu, all the other Jedi use the edge, which requires a wide space to deliver a stroke. This explains why Palpatine was able to kill so many Jedi in such a short period of time.
Yeah, because no Jedi had ever thought, ooh, thrust
this. There's no artistry in killing with the tip.
Even though in the first movie, they open a door by pushing the tip through a doorway.
Yeah.
So they know that the tip is hurting.
Well, the other problem I don't know. It's a massive design flaw in the lightsaber is that it cauterizes the limb as soon as it cuts it off, so no one's going to bleed out. Like, nobody dies. They just replace a robotic limb.
Yeah. That's exactly right.
But how else can you show someone in peril? If they're missing a limb, they're in trouble. If they're not missing a limb, they're okay.
They're all right. I've got all my limbs.
But this is the best bit of trivia from this film.
Burnt my eyebrows off, but I've got all my limbs.
Another callback maybe, Bros, but this is the best bit of trivia from this film. When Obi-Wan, Anakin, and Palpatine are landing near the politicians in the transport ship, in the shot where they fly to the landing pad, you can see the Millennium Falcon docking into the bay at the bottom left-hand side of the shot.
That's cool.
So that's probably...
Best scene of the film.
Yeah.
There are a bunch of those little sight gags. A gag I use in inverted commas because I'm pretty sure George Lucas doesn't know what a gag is. But they're in one of the films...
There's a little E.T. in the corner.
Yeah, there's E.T.'s in the Senate. There's TIE fighters from the original films that are on Coruscant. And there's all these little dino visual gags that aren't there anything to do with the plot. They're just there for...
Fan service,
basically, and also for their own entertainment. Anyway, there's all those little ton of visual gags that aren't funny, but are there, and you can find them. And there's a lot of them, and that is more interesting. It makes the prequels into like a Where's Wally book. And you're just like, where's this bit and where's that bit? That's
kind of
tasty.
It does have a point.
Yeah, kind of. That's the only entertainment value these films will give you. Yeah.
Good.
In regards to the DVD and Blu-ray releases for Revenge of the Sith, that was released on DVD in 2005... The DVD included a number of documentaries, including a new full-length documentary, as well as two featurettes, one which explores the prophecy of Anakin Skywalker as the Chosen One.
I watched that. It's really bad.
That prophecy's so flawed.
Oh, God, yeah. And the other, looking at the film stunts and sort of a 15-part collection of web documentaries.
Yeah, I didn't get through the web ones. I watched the feature-length doco. It's actually really cool. 60 Seconds of the Volcano lightsaber fight. It goes into detail to all the different levels of people involved with doing that 1 60-second moment. So it starts with obviously the acting and the performances and things like that, and then all the CGI and all the levels of CGI, so the design work and then the animation and the compositing and all that stuff, and then the audio and the music. And if you don't know anything about how CGI and film works and you can stand that 1 60-second sequence, it's kind of a nice way to unpack and understand how it all works in modern film and how CGI, 200 people involved with 60 seconds of film. Obviously they're involved with all of the film, but it's really cool. There's this really funny moment towards the end of that doco where they're sitting in this theaterette, Lucas and McCallum and those guys. Ben Burtt's in there. Ben Burtt's sitting behind a computer with all these audio sound effects and everything on it. And then the music editor, who's not Williams, but the actual editor, he's sitting there in front of a computer, and they're using Pro Tools, and they can access all the audio for the film from the theaterette while watching it, and they're editing it with everyone in the room. And there's this nice little moment where Ben Burtt argues that the sound effects should be a bit louder, and then the music editor has a bit of a sulk that's like, and like, oh, what do you think of that? And he's like, oh, you don't like it, do you? He's like, well, the music just, you can't even. Oh.
That sounds great.
You just can't even. And the music editor is basically having a bit of a sook because all of a sudden you can't hear any of John Williams' music.
Oh, wow. That's great. I reckon that happens quite a bit.
And yeah. But then when I watch the sequence again after seeing this doco, I'm like, yeah, the music could be a little bit louder here. Oh. It is a bit sound effects heavy. It's a bit like it could create a little bit more tension if the music's really pushed to the back. So yeah, I can understand why he's having a sulk. And he got it brought up a little bit in, like, he's like, oh, how about if we do that? He's like, are you happier now? I'm like, yeah, I'm happier now.
Oh wow.
But yeah, it's a really
worst option.
it's interesting though. There's actually right. footage of that music editor at the film's premiere, and he's on the red carpet going, no.
But yeah, that doco's it wasn't bad. I quite enjoyed it just to see all the different levels of production, stunt work and all that stuff being integrated into 1 60-second sequence.
And like the other DVD releases, Brose, it's got an audio commentary featuring Lucas, producer Rick McCallum, animation director Rob Coleman, and ILM visual effects supervisors John Knoll and Roger Guyot.
Mm.
So did you check this one out, Brose? And what was this one like in comparison to the others?
You'll notice there's a name missing on that list that's been in 5 of the 6 commentaries and isn't in this one. Ben Burtt.
Oh.
There is no Ben Burtt.
Hold on a sec.
You might have heard me say
that. Hold on. You said the only highlights of the other ones was Ben Burtt.
Yes. Ooh. You might remember the highlights of all commentaries for all Star Wars films.
For weeks, bro.
Is Ben Burtt.
We've been waiting for weeks for a good commentary, and we're not getting it this week, are we?
No Ben Burtt. Ben Burtt is by far the best thing about all the Star Wars films. As far as I'm, he's the one. He's my R2. He is consistent. He is brilliant. He's so passionate, and he's so creative, and he's so revolutionary. He was early on, and nothing on this commentary from him at all. Not even a sneeze in the background. The other thing is, and you'll love this, the CGI guys keep referring to what they call like quintessential Star Wars moments. Or this is a really Star Wars moment, or this is so Star Wars, whenever they refer to scenes entirely created in CGI.
Why are you surprised?
But that's
is really George Lucas.
But that Star really Wars. Explains the whole philosophy behind these prequels, I think. Because they're not Star Wars moments. Great Star Wars moments
have
are Han Solo saying, you know, I know, when Leia says, I love you. Yep. Great Star Wars moments are Obi-Wan Kenobi in the first... Like, there are Yoda on Dagobah. There are some great Star Wars moments, and they got fuck all to do with CGI. But on Revenge of the Sith, taking Anakin and Obi-Wan and shrinking them down and making the whole place huge and massive and... That's a great Star Wars moment.
I have a question.
Anyway, 0 stars for this commentary. It can go fuck itself.
I have a question.
That good, eh?
About that, actually. Just about great moments in Star Wars movies. Now, when Vader kills Obi-Wan Kenobi, a couple of things happen. One is he disappears.
Yeah.
And his robe is left on the floor. And then he becomes part of the living force.
Yeah.
But that doesn't seem to happen to anybody else.
Yoda.
Right.
Doesn't Yoda disappear?
Yeah,
Yoda disappears.
In the original trilogies, it does. And Anakin as well.
Yeah.
But in the prequels, I think at the end, they allude to Qui-Gon Jinn.
They explain that by saying
they're only just learning.
They're only learning how to do it.
No, that's
yeah. And then right at the end, they say, right at the end of when Yoda says, or tells Obi-Wan to go to Tatooine, he says, you have an old friend there who has learnt how to communicate to us from beyond the Force, and he will continue your training.
Yeah, it's
and he says Qui-Gon or something equally as pitiful.
It's
annoying.
It's like, we didn't do this thing for 3 films. Oh, we better explain it because the Jedi's an ancient thing, but in one generation we learn how to circumvent
death. But
that's
the point of good writing is that you're allowed to have backstory. You don't need to explain it all.
Don't explain all the backstory.
Don't make a prequel 20 years later.
The other thing too, one of the things they failed in this film to do, which they could have, is really balance the idea of Anakin wanting to learn the dark force to save Padme and the idea the Jedi's have learned to circumvent death. Those two things are parallel, or they're related, but at no point does the script use them to kind of counter each other or balance out each other, because at the end of the day, the Jedi have learnt how to, you know, how to live after death, but the dark force have or haven't. We don't even know if that's true. Is Sidious just telling him that because that's what he wants to hear?
Like, I don't know.
Then, of course, all the Star Wars films came out on Blu-ray in 2011. But, of course, the big thing with the entire Star Wars series on home video is the fact that we're still waiting for the original three movies. And we've spoken about this numerous times
they'll
on the show.
Out.
They will. There's no question.
Disney needs to make some coin. They'll come out.
Our prediction was...
The theatrical version?
Yeah, the ones that originally
showed. When 7 comes out.
1977
comes out. They're the ones I watched.
We preempted on our previous shows that when 7's home video release comes out next year, they'll probably try and tie it in with the others and put them all together.
I actually think probably the conversion of those old films are going to take a long time, because there's a pan and scan version as a bonus disc on the DVDs, and that's not a very good...
No, that's a letterbox.
That's what I watched this week, because I couldn't bear watching the CGI.
That's what I've been watching.
So I think they're going to actually have to restore it really from the negatives from the start, and I think that'll take a long time. So I think it'll be beautiful when it comes out, but I think they're going
to lovingly restore it. They've got to do it. And the other thing too, The ongoing problem with Disney now is that Force Awakens... Okay, let's get excited about Force Awakens. It's the first Star Wars film in 10 years. It's the first Star Wars film that George Lucas can't fuck up. Blah, 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 blah. But Disney are using this film to launch a flood of Star Wars films. So after The Force Awakens, no other Star Wars film will ever be as special as, say, Phantom Menace was supposed to be, or Force Awakens is potentially, ever again. Because we're going to get a Star Wars film every year. They're not going to be every 3 years, every 5 years, 10-year break, 20-year break. None of that's going to happen. We're going to have Star Wars universe films every year until Disney has wrung every last dollar out of them. And that's good. That's not necessarily a negative in terms of I'd love to watch a Star Wars film every year as long as it's as good as the first three or whatever. That's great. I couldn't think of anything better. But it's also bad. It's no longer going to be a special thing. It's just going to become a part of the pop culture ether as a regular, you know, new installments just exist constantly. So it's a real catch-22. Like, my point being there too is that if they had any brains at Disney, they get a New Hope original release restored, release it at cinemas, spend a year off from new Star Wars films, release that on Blu-ray and DVD, then have a new film come out, space everything out, and use the old films to kind of give us some Star Wars in the meantime, but also give us the Star Wars we want. But if you can imagine next year, Force Awakens is on Blu-ray. If they release, say, a New Hope restored original theatrical release on Blu-ray, then Rogue One comes out. And then in 2017, we get Rogue One on Blu-ray. And maybe, like, how much Star Wars can we take?
Well,
I feel like I've just depressed everybody, apparently.
Yeah.
But yeah, no, I'm just curious how Disney are going to handle it now, because it's a whole different area all of a sudden.
Thanks for joining us.
Yeah. And, you know, as long as Ben Burtt's involved in each film, then I'll be happy.
Well, how many people at this table are excited by what Brose is just speaking about?
that idea of having constant Star Wars all the time.
I honestly think
for me it's different, like, because Star Wars, the original three films for me, are my childhood, my growing up. Now, you can make 35 new Star Wars films. You can make no Star Wars films. It doesn't change what those three films mean to me. Now, possibly what a new film every year or a new film every 20 seconds does is it maybe makes me think about those old films. Maybe I watch them again and I think about them and I think about whether I still like them, what they mean to me. But aside from reminding me of the old Star Wars films, the new Star Wars films to me are the new Star Wars films. They're not, they're a little bit for me, but they're not just for me. They're for everybody. They're for maybe a new generation if they're done right. And that's fine. You know, if we never get another Star Wars movie again, it doesn't change how I feel about those original three films. If we get 35 Star Wars films, it doesn't change how I feel about those first three.
Yeah. You can never screw them up by just making more.
Well, I think these prequels
are the proof of that.
That's a question, though. Have the prequels detracted from the original films for you in any shape or form?
I don't think so. I think the Star Wars universe exists in my head based on those original three films. And so when the prequels just came out, I just decided they didn't exist.
You know what
and
it
I
is?
Just didn't, you know, take it on board.
Yeah.
Didn't fit in my story. Yeah. Didn't fit in my view of Star Wars.
Yeah. Interesting.
Brose, if I, like, you know, I might be dead in the gutter, but if they have announced Back to the Future 4 or did a Back to the Future remake, I'd hate that decision.
Yeah, I would
obviously
be really scared.
No, I would be, right? But you can never take the original and the original trilogy away. Like, it's not going to be like, oh my God, they've just screwed everything up.
Yeah.
In fact, sometimes bad sequels, bad prequels, bad remakes make the originals look even better.
Yeah, well, can I use an analogy here? It's a bit tortured, but for example, I really like the song Real Love by the Beatles. That's a good song, right?
Yep.
Now, if I go to a bar and a terrible covers band is performing that song, I go, oh, that's awful. Oh, that's terrible. But it doesn't ruin the song for me. It's just, oh, that's a bad version of that song. These prequels are bad versions of Star Wars, but that's okay because at home there's a good version of Star Wars.
Yeah. Yep. And I guess the other thing too,
thanks, man.
In terms of Disney's ongoing success, it doesn't matter how good the new films are; they can still make a shitload of money if they re-release those original theatrical films.
Yep.
Yeah.
Let's move on and talk about John Williams' score.
Yes.
From Revenge of the Sith, because this one's memorable.
Well, do you know what? The only memorable bits of it is when they play the Imperial March. So,
again, going back to previous material. That's
it. That's a really tasty moment when Yoda walks into Sidious's office and just knocks out the two Imperial guards. That's really cool.
Yeah, that's good.
You're out of here.
Oh, yeah, that's a nice moment. A great little moment. But, in the absence of Andrew, James is going to be taking on the reins of this section again for us.
Hello.
So, James, what have you got for us in regards to John Williams' score here?
Okay, so let's start with the facts. The soundtrack to Star Wars Episode 3, Revenge of the Sith, was released by Sony Classical on May the 3rd, 2005, more than 2 weeks before the film's release. The music, as always, was composed and conducted by John Williams and performed by the London Symphony Orchestra and the London Voices. Once again, he's returned to that very choral theme that he's really peppered the prequels with, which is a theme that is absent from those original scores. A music video titled A Hero Falls, put the S in the wrong place there, was created for the film's theme, Battle of the Heroes, featuring footage from the film. In the UK, Battle of the Heroes was released as a CD single.
Wow.
And reached 25 in the UK singles charts in June 2005. The soundtrack also came with a collector's DVD, Star Wars, A Musical Journey. At no additional cost, the DVD features 16 music videos set to remastered selections of music from all 6 film scores set chronologically through the saga. It was not nominated for an Academy Award or a Golden Globe Award or anything else. This album was chosen as one of Amazon.com's top 100 editors' picks of 2005. So them's the facts.
Top 100. Wow.
Top 100. Let's talk a little bit about the actual score itself. I've been following the Williams scores throughout the prequels, and I feel like he's on the journey with us in terms of desolation
and
despair.
In terms of his confusion.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
I can really tell.
I think I characterised the Phantom Menace score as being a drunk man at 3 a.m. playing the score on a piano bar. Sort of like, there's your fucking Star Wars score. I think the second one is just sort of confusing, and I think the third one he's really given up. To go with what Jade was saying earlier, it really is a case of, in the early films, when you hear themes from the original trilogy, your heart rises a little bit. But in this movie, when he does very rarely take themes from the original trilogy and weave them into the new score, you actually feel sadder because he's reminding you of better movies and better times.
Yeah.
And it
point.
Actually... And for the rest of the score, for me, really sounds like kind of that pipe organ Carmina Burana-style music that Channel 9 are very fond of putting under their Big Bang Theory promotions. Or, like, you know, Who Wants to Be a Millionaire game shows. They have those kind of... That's what the score is to me. It's these...
Do, 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 that kind of shit.
That sort of thing. And it's just these ponderous, it's like, stabs and stings. It sounds like... John Williams has loaded a choir into a cannon and fired them at a pipe organ.
I'd like to hear that.
Me too. But that's what this score is. It's just sort of disconnected stings and things. And it's not, again, it's not Williams' fault. He's got nothing to hang on to. But it really does feel like this is the most disconnected his music's been from possibly any movie he's ever done.
I think you summed it up best I think it was Phantom Menace, where you just said, you know, the score is supposed to reflect what's going on the screen, and there is nothing for him to work with.
No.
Yeah, and
nothing. No soul, no chemistry, nothing for him to work with, and this is what you produce, and this is why great films and great scores go together consistently, because everyone's feeding off each other. But
in Star Wars particularly, Williams works with themes really heavily, and I think that was a huge problem in the prequels, but you never knew whose story you were supposed to be you know, empathizing with. So there was no, Williams never really knew which theme or whose point of view to play the music towards, if that makes sense.
Yeah, it does. Yeah. Yeah, definitely.
But also there's a chance, Lucas didn't really know either.
Yeah.
Like, well, that wasn't in the script. That was done in editing. So it's kind of... Yeah.
Well, I think that was the problem, is it feels like John, and I think Brose talked about this when he was watching one of the makings of, is that, you know, John Williams, you know, was given the same brief as everyone else. You know, well, something will happen. There are some characters, there's some green screen. And so how do you write a character theme for this, you know, that time around?
Yeah.
Yeah, good on him for pulling something out.
Yeah. And there's a 15-track release of the score as well, James?
That's correct. Single disc. Look, I mean, it did very well. But it, as I said, it's the album was very popular. But, you know, it's a series of orchestral cues. It's probably preferable listening to it than watching the movie because it's shorter.
Limitations of a CD.
Yes, of course. And less CGI. But, you know, other than that.
Okay. Yeah, so... That's pretty much it then.
That's it.
There we go. In regards to alternate versions or deleted scenes, during the process of shaping the film for its theatrical release, Lucas and his editors dropped many scenes and even an entire subplot from the completed film.
You know what the subplot was, don't you?
The actual plot?
Oh, this I watched the deleted... It's
a plot?
Let me just set it up this way, right? Of all the elements of the prequels, what's the one thing when you watch them you think, if only there was more of that?
Nudity.
Obi-Wan Kenobi.
Politics. Yay!
Exactly.
More politics, Lucas. That's what we want. Yay! I watched the new sequel to Star Wars. It's called Question Time on the ABC.
So Lucas exiled all the scenes of a group of senators, including Padme, organising an alliance to prevent the Chancellor from receiving any more emergency powers.
Yeah, wow. Awesome. You know? Action-packed. It's them sitting around different rooms talking about it. And then they talk about not being able to talk about it to anyone not in the room. Padme can't stand that because she wants to tell Anakin. Because he can't just force it out of her. In terms of he can't use the force to work out what she's doing, apparently.
Yeah, but...
Or to tell that she's carrying twins.
Yeah.
Exactly. The scene where Yoda arrives on Dagobah to begin his self-imposed exile was also cut, but he's featured...
That's a beautiful little sequence, but completely irrelevant.
Yeah, that's actually on the DVD release.
Yeah, it's him landing on Dagobah, getting out of his spaceship. It's unnecessary, but it's nice.
There's this. Producer McCallum stated that he hopes Lucas may add it to the release if Lucas ever does another re-release of the Star Wars movies.
Yeah.
Because people just, like, you know, like, we can't wait for changes to the prequels.
I know when I watched Empire, I just thought, okay, Yoda's on Dagobah, but how did he get here? What were the exact circumstances of his arrival?
Where did he learn the recipe for that delicious soup?
Collectibles from Revenge of the Sith, Brose. What have you got for us?
So, a couple of things. So, Hasbro released this, whatever they are, 2-inch figures, to 3 1/4-inch figures. These are the best figures out of the whole three prequels. The sculpts are amazing, the action features are better, the articulation's better. I may or may not have bought hologram Yoda special edition Toys R Us exclusive on eBay as I was researching the toy. I've got about 16 Yoda figures already, 16 or 17, so I was just adding to my existing collection, but it's the little hologram Yoda, you know, from the end of Jedi, and so it's just basically a transparent action figure. So when it's sitting on the shelf, you won't even be able to see it. So I'm glad I've got that. But
I think if your Wi-Fi is good, you can see it.
but the figures for this are really good. Like I got a bit excited looking at the images of them online, and hence I bought one. But yeah, I mean, and the other great thing about these figures is, for the first time, there's a really great collection of kind of scale. So you've got these great big Wookiees and Yoda and little droids and humans, and you get that Bruce Spence character's got a bit of high, skinny. It's kind of visually, it's very pleasing to see all these different shapes. There's nothing worse in an action figure set when everyone's the same size and everyone's basically the same body shape. It's nice to have different shapes and sizes, and this series has those as well. There's a combination, again, of classic characters. All of the Darth Vaders in this series are fucking awful because it's Hayden Christensen inside the plastic toy, but otherwise, I really, really, really like these toys.
Yeah,
Not enough to own any, but except the Yoda.
I may or may not have also purchased.
What did you buy?
We need to say something for a while. I can see it in your face.
It wasn't a little action figure. I may have bought my dad for Christmas a blow-up remote control R2-D2.
Oh, I've seen those. They're awesome. Awesome.
I know.
I love R2. The other thing I want to mention, so I've concentrated mainly on the Kenner Hasbro toys in all the Star Wars episodes, but at this point I just wanted to highlight quickly the amazing work yet again done by Hot Toys. The Hot Toys Star Wars 12-inch figures are phenomenal and will blow your brain in half. They're worth $350 each. They're not cheap. Here's an interesting little collection, though, for you. These are the characters Hot Toys have released in 1/6 scale 12-inch figures so far. And see if you can spot a theme here. Han Solo, Chewbacca, Stormtrooper, Darth Vader, Obi-Wan Kenobi, Space Trooper, Sand Trooper, Luke Skywalker, Princess Leia, Stormtrooper Luke Skywalker Disguise. They're about to release a 1/6 scale version of the Millennium Falcon cockpit, TIE Fighter pilot, and a 1/6 scale TIE Fighter.
Yeah, right.
All from the first movie.
All original.
All from the original films, yep. And for Force Awakens, they're releasing another 12 figures. A bunch of Stormtroopers, Kylo Ren and Captain Phasma are coming out in that series as well. And these will blow your mind. They're just phenomenal toys. So if you want
anything they do, Brose.
What's that?
Sideshow, Hot Toys. Like anything that they do.
It's phenomenal.
It's phenomenal. Yeah. They are amazing.
And I finally answered the question because there's a weird Hot Toys Sideshow collectibles relationship that I could never work out. Hot Toys are a Japanese company. They're distributed exclusively in Australia, the US, the UK, or whatever, by Sideshow Collectibles. Sideshow Collectibles released their own 12-inch figures in the 2000s, and they're fucking awful. They're really plasticky-looking, bad sculpts. The hair just looks awful. But they're a lot cheaper, though. They're like $90 rather than these $200 or $300 figures. But stay away from the Sideshow ones. Definitely get the Hot Toys. The Han Solo and Chewbacca, just wow, just incredible figures.
It's so weird, though, because when I type Hot Toy 12-inch into Google,
that's
not important.
It's a whole different thing. As far as I know, these ones aren't battery-operated.
Ah, good. Good.
That also being said... so, yeah, Hot Toys stuff are great. Check out their website. And also, just quickly, I'm going to pop up on probably on Twitter and Facebook over the next couple of weeks. There's a bunch of really cool collectible stores in Melbourne if you're a Melbourne-based listener and if you're curious the best places. Increasingly, buying things from the States is not as affordable as it used to be. Shipping is a lot more expensive and the dollar's not as strong as it was. So this is really weird for me after about 10 years of buying stuff on eBay. I've now gone back to buying collectibles from shops. Like, I really thought the eBay age was just going to change my life and I'd buy things on eBay the rest of my life. But with the conversion and the shipping, it's just not worth my while.
What's a shop?
I know, that's bizarre. So to that end, I want to point listeners in Melbourne, at least, in the direction. A lot of these shops are on eBay as well and are online and are worth looking at. Go Figure Collectibles are in North Coburg in Melbourne. Just Collectibles are in Jordanville. Lobos Collectibles in Thornbury. Evil Empire are down in Coburg as well. They're exceptional. Classic Comics in the city, All-Star Comics in the city. And Play, who do DVD and Blu-ray and stuff, are phenomenal. They're in the city as well in Melbourne. A lot of these guys are online and some of them do free shipping around Australia as well. The Yoda I bought was free shipping to here, which was cool. But go out and explore these shops and find these toys. Some of them are just incredible. And look after these local guys that have managed through the eBay era and are still there. And I know, for example, I was looking at the Marty McFly, Michael J. Fox, 12-inch Hot Toys, a really good price at one of the shops I was looking at. I'm not going to reveal where it is because I still want to go back and buy it.
Probably you got to tell me after the show, bro.
Maybe he's only got one left.
just what you got to do is you got to tell him and then travel back in time.
That's right. But yeah. I mean, it's worth looking after these guys because they've been around the whole time while we've been shopping elsewhere, and they're very affordable. Some of the prices are exceptional. But anyway, I'll put some of the links up on our
great
social media.
No, thanks a lot, Brose. Just quickly in regards to the awards for Revenge of the Sith, they always seem to find their way into the Academy Awards for something.
Oh, what'd they get this time?
Technical side of things. At the Academy Awards 2006, nominated Best Achievement in Makeup.
There you
go. Okay.
Fair enough.
But, Brose, when we did look at these prequel films, we always talk about the Satins here on Real Chat. We love the Satins. But they had a lot of love for the Star Wars prequels. So it won, Brose, Best Science Fiction Film. Nominated. Right. Best Actor, Hayden Christensen.
Who nominated? His mum nominated him. Yeah.
Best Actress, Natalie Portman.
Her mum nominated her.
Best Supporting Actor, Ian McDiarmid.
I'll buy that one.
Best Director, George Lucas.
Self-nominated.
Also, Best Writing, George Lucas.
He bought the Saturn Awards, I think.
His awards, yeah.
He owns them now.
The whole ceremony was a CGI construct.
Yeah. Best Costume to Trisha Biggar. Best Makeup and also Best Special Effects. So, But no. Occasionally, Brose, we pull out some special awards, like the Razzie Awards in 2006, hey. Where it won the Razzie for Worst Supporting Actor, Hayden Christensen.
Well deserved.
I love that they didn't even make him the best main actor. They wouldn't even say, not even the best actor.
Supporting, yeah. That's it. And at the Stinkers Bad Movie Awards.
The Stinkers? Where did these come from?
Nominated Worst Screenplay for a Film Grossing More Than $100 million Using Hollywood Math.
Right.
George Lucas.
Okay.
The Stinkers, does that award ceremony take place in a playground? Like, what is going on there?
It was going to be called the Fartsies.
Yeah.
They changed it to the Stinkers.
The Yuckies.
The Yucky Yucks.
Also nominated... How did it not win this? That's what I want to know. Worst on-screen couple to Hayden Christensen and Natalie Portman. How did it not win that?
Who won
what
that
couple
year?
Were worse?
Was
than...
it like...
I think it possibly lost to, I don't know, Hitler and Goebbels. Were they in a movie that year?
Oh, that's so
wrong.
It was
2005, wrong. Wasn't it?
Yeah.
Can't even think of what else was out that year.
The Rotten Tomatoes website certifies Revenge of the Sith fresh. With a score of 79%, 146 positive, and only 73 negative.
That's a lot of people in denial in the world. A lot of people who think that it's good because it's Star Wars.
Or George Lucas just pressing reviews again and again.
In a 2007 summary of the 100 best science fiction films on Rotten Tomatoes, Revenge of the Sith was placed 51 out of 100, making it the only prequel film in the Star Wars series to earn a ranking.
Yeah, money changed hands, I guess.
Yep. IMDb, 7.7 out of 10.
That's a lot.
That's way, way too high.
Way too
high. Should have been ranking at least...
Like the IMDb score...
High fives, early sixes at best.
People. So I think, yeah, it's not just... James, it's not just the reviewers that were lost in the romance of it all. It was the people as well, the fans.
You know what it is? It's like, Star Wars is a football team, and so everyone barracks for Star Wars.
Yeah.
So it's one of those things where, you know, if your team plays badly, you don't give up on the team.
Yeah.
So, entertainment is sport sometimes, especially voting. So I think everyone went, oh, I've got to support the team. Team's done badly. Oh, we lost that one, but we better keep going.
Yeah.
What if we give it a bad score and they don't make any more Star Wars movies? Yeah. I'll give it 10, it's Star Wars.
Yep,
yeah, they're
exactly.
Voting for the phenomenon, not the movie itself.
They want it to be good. They're willing it to be good. You barrack for your team to win next week.
The Star Wars, the perpetual hope.
That's great. I would see that.
Yeah, I would see that too. It's just one after the other, scene after scene of anticlimax after anticlimax.
And just people looking wide-eyed into the camera going, it's okay, the next one's going to be amazing.
Yeah. Rose, let's wrap this up with our traditional 5-star review system per guest. And I'm going to start here with your good self today, Brose. So,
yes.
Revenge of the Sith.
I actually felt okay after watching this film. You know, it's better. It's the best of the worst. And I was going to give it, I was going to give it like 2.5 stars or something. I was kind of full of confidence and happiness, and then we talked about it and fuck this film and fuck George Lucas. 1 star.
Whoa, did you just drop that star and a half?
Yep. No, you know what? I'm angry at this film for not being the better film. It's not much better. It's slightly better. It's slightly better, like drinking a shot of cyanide or a shot of cyanide with a pinch of salt in it, to use James's analogy earlier. It's still cyanide, it's still evil, and it's still shit.
What did you give the last two, though?
No, ones or something. I don't fucking know. I don't care.
Because I think I'm pretty sure you gave Attack of the Clones more than that, so it doesn't make any sense.
What did I give Attack of the Clones?
I can't remember.
Well, you're not helping, are you? Is it updated on the website? What's going on? I have no idea.
Here's what I'm saying, is that the fact that you're so apathetic about even anything, I think one stands.
Yeah. I'm just angry at this film for not being the film that it was supposed to be. It's not the better film. If it is, it's by millimeters, so it's irrelevant. Hayden Christensen stinks everything up like a stinky stink bum. And... And that annoys me.
Yeah, that George Lucas. Now that's motherfucking writing. You hear that?
The fact that CGI'd his way all the way through this. The fact that it's watching the making of and seeing how pathetic it was. Just fuck him. 1 star.
Wow.
Nah.
There you go.
I'm done. I'm washing my hands.
I'm going to read between the lines and say that's a not recommend. As well.
Yeah, and you know what? I don't recommend it. And I'll go one step further. Anyone that tells you this film's worth watching because it's the best prequel, is evil as Lucas is for making these films, that's not a good enough reason to watch it. Being better than shit is not good enough. Being slightly average is not good enough. Cinema is for greatness, and Lucas should have his membership cancelled.
Amen. There you go. Okay.
Fuck.
James.
Hard act to follow. That was beautiful. I'd like to open my review by reading you the opening sentence of the opening to this film. War! Exclamation point.
What is it good for?
If only. If only you'd written that. War, he writes. The Republic is crumbling under attacks by the ruthless Sith Lord Count Dooku. There are heroes on both sides. Evil is everywhere. Now, if a 12-year-old submitted that as a book report, you'd give him a D and ask him to do some research next time. That is the opening of this movie. Those meaningless, dumb sentences. And it doesn't get any better from there on in. I side with Brose on this. I don't think this movie, and having watched it for the first time for this podcast, and having heard that it's the best of the three and rah, 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 it's telling the best story, and it doesn't even succeed at that. I think the stakes are higher, and so I feel the loss more. I also give it one. Don't see this movie. Live your lives. Go for a walk. Read a book. The end.
One star.
And I gave Attack of the Clones 1 star, and I gave Phantom Menace 0 stars.
Yep.
And you know, and just to spite James, it's a poorly CGI'd fucking star, and it wasn't in the original script, and it was put in during a reshoot, and it doesn't look convincing. That star is Hayden Christensen.
Jade.
Sorry, wow. Bro's just disappeared into his own metaphor. Did anyone else see that?
Into a black hole.
Wow, 5. No.
Now that's a twist, George Lucas. Did you hear that?
I think I'm a bit unfamiliar with the rating system, but I think I would have given Phantom of Menace 0. Probably also would have given Attack of the Clones 0.
Yes.
I think this deserves a pity point.
Just a pity point.
But I'm going to raise it controversially to maybe two stars.
Yep.
Just because I actually would recommend it, just so that you can spend hours of joy debating about how crap it is. It can give you a lot of vitriol. Oh,
I think people recommend heroin the same way.
Yeah. Try it at least once. No. That's not my formal stance as a doctor. That's not my formal professional opinion as a doctor.
That's not Jade's opinion of heroin. It's her opinion of the McRib. Try it at least once. That sauce is delicious.
Yeah. So 2 stars and a recommend.
Yeah.
Yeah. Great. That's probably the most interesting review we've had so far here on Red
I was Chat going to give it 2.5, but I'm angry at it now. Ask me tomorrow, it'll be 2 stars.
It seems that the discussion on the films can actually really drop people's scores. I've noticed that about our show.
Yeah, the discussion of Menace and Clones hasn't upset me as much as this. This is kind of just disappointing. Adam, I think it's time that you have
the final word. Okay, now, I know you're not going to like this start, James, but it is the strongest installment of the prequel trilogy. So yes, it is. But no, that does not make it a great or even a remotely good film. The concept behind Anakin's turn into the Empire should be incredible. But the execution continues to leave so much to be desired. I will say it's probably the most visually interesting of the prequels. And, you know, some of the CGI is okay. The backgrounds and the environments are still the worst offender, though, with the digitally manufactured sets draining much of the life behind anything. I wish I could... You know what?
No! Adam has thrown his notes away! Never before in real chat history has this happened! Oh, they're gone!
There it is.
He can't even... He's just lost all enthusiasm
this
for his own vitriol.
Film. So much squandered... So much potential squandered. George Lucas is a visionary, and I worship him for the original trilogy, but he needed less yes men and more collaborative partners for this trilogy. It can't just all be you, George. It doesn't work like that.
Correct.
1 star, not recommend. And that's, thank God we've hit the end of Star Wars, at least to the new one.
Well, hang on. We're all getting back together to do the Star Wars Christmas special, aren't we?
Yeah. Oh, God.
We should totally do that.
Thank God we got through that, bros. And I can't... We were going to put all those into, like, one episode.
Remember? We were.
Yeah, so thanks for having me for this crap film, assholes.
Wait till we do June, and then you'll be back.
Yes. Don't worry. We've got to make it up to both Jade and James big time, bros. That's the one thing
I have never done a film I've liked on this podcast.
So, guys, I just want to wrap up Star Wars as it stands today.
You're not going to crack the shits and rip
this
up,
just quickly, guys, everyone's opinion here. I want you actually to rank the 6 Star Wars films from best to worst, right? And I also want your personal opinion, which I think is going to be around the board, about what your franchise cutoff point is, which I think is going to be in the same spot for all of us. just a guess, really. But anyway, so I'll start off quickly, okay? So I'm going to rank the 6 Star Wars movies from best to worst, right? It's really black and white for me. It's really easy, okay? 5, 4, 6, 3, 1, 2.
Thunderbirds are go.
Yeah. And that was Adam attempting to count.
That was Adam's pin number for everyone.
Mine is
almost the same as yours. Mine is Empire Strikes Back, then in best to worst, Empire Strikes Back, Star Wars, Return of the Jedi. Then I would go Revenge of the Sith. The only ones we would disagree on is I'd say Attack of the Clones is the 5th worst. I would put Phantom Menace at the absolute bottom of that disgusting barrel.
Okay. Jade.
I think at the moment, episode 4 is my number... I'm just going to let him go for a sec.
Now that's a review. That is a review. That is a dog
at home. His dog just urinated in the corner, and I think it was right on cue.
I think it's when he heard, I think he's trained to urinate when he hears the words George Lucas. Isn't that right, bro? Good boy.
Training there, bro.
Phantom Menace.
So I would rank episode 4, episode 5, episode 6, and just refuse to accept that there are any further Star Wars films to rank. I can't even. They don't deserve a. No, sorry.
Wow.
4, 5, 6.
Okay, so I'm going to assume that is Jade's cutoff point as well.
Yeah. Yeah. Basically, I'm at the same point with the prequels that I'm at with Ghostbusters 2. I have no need to watch these films ever again. I don't need to acknowledge that they exist. I don't even need to refer to them in any way, shape, or form. They're a bad reflection. They're a shadow of the pre-existing films. I think Empire's the best, and then Jedi and Star Wars are neck and neck for me, and then these don't exist, so it's fine. I know you're going to have a go at me about Ghostbusters 2, but that film can go fuck itself as well. George Lucas and Ghostbusters 2 can disappear into a deep hole and I never have to...
I mean, just for Pete Venkman's world of psychic, that film's not bad.
It
is a 5-star film, bros, in comparison to these prequels.
No, it's a 3-star film. It's a 2-star film in comparison to these prequels, but that's all right.
I know how you feel.
All right. Download Ghostbusters 2 podcast for real chat. It's on iTunes.
Absolutely.
Check it out.
Go do that.
Liam Neeson's not even in Ghostbusters 2, bro.
Well, actually, maybe he is one of those. Maybe he's one of the ghosts that they bust.
One of the brothers.
The Force ghost.
Force ghost.
Yeah. I'd like to see the Ghostbusters busting a Force ghost.
Yeah, like the franchise cutoff point, just quickly. Obviously, we can reevaluate this as they make more films. But the franchise cutoff point for me personally is definitely watch the original trilogy. You do not need to see the prequels.
No,
James?
Not at all.
Yeah, agreed. Absolutely agreed.
I completely agree. Yeah,
definitely. And Brose?
Yeah, of course. Cool. There are no prequels.
All right. Well, we've come to the end of Star Wars as it stands right now, everybody. But our next episode, Brose, we're getting there. Milestone.
Episode 7, The Force Awakens.
Yes.
And Real Chat's 50th episode.
And we've got quite a lot of special stuff planned for this one.
We're going to have a banner, and we're going to run through it like it's a football game. It's going to be all. There's going to be a pithy limerick on the front.
It's going to be released probably maybe 4 or 5 days after the film comes out.
A couple of days late.
Because a lot of people are seeing this film pretty early and pretty straightforward. So
Force Awakens in the States, anyways, already sold $50 million worth of tickets. Force Awakens has almost beaten in pre-sales the recent Fantastic Four film.
Oh, wow.
In total.
In pre-sales.
Yeah.
Which was a major disappointment, by the way.
Yes.
Yeah.
No one else saw it, so.
Wow.
But, yeah, so we're going to, we're going to have a Periscope going, Brose, and we're going to, we're going to try some new things, and we're going to have a large team for it as well, Brose.
We're going to try and get as many of the Real Chat regulars as we can to sit around the table and talk Star Wars, and that'll be released probably Monday or Tuesday after The Force Awakens comes out, which is the 21st, 22nd of December.
For episode 50, but I can't believe we're here, bro. It's only taken 1 year.
Who would have thought?
Thanks a lot, James, for coming in.
My pleasure.
Through the prequel series. I can't believe you just did that.
My pleasure. In closing, may I shamelessly plug my own podcast?
You can.
Of course.
TheatreOfTheWorld.com.
And Jade, thank you so much again for coming and indulging with us today. And for coming on the Revenge of the Sith of all movies.
I still don't forgive you for that, but still.
We've got to make it up to you now, that's right.
That's all right.
Just keep an eye out or an ear out for Janis Malicious.
Oh, fantastic. Brose, thanks a lot, mate.
Oh, thank you. Good work. Well done. Right. Yeah, awesome.
Yeah.
That's great. Good on you. Are we still recording? You can keep in touch with us here at Real Chat by visiting realchat.com.au. Check us out on Twitter at Real Chat Podcast, Instagram, real_chat_podcast, and we're on YouTube, Real Chat Podcast, surprise, surprise, and track us down on Facebook. You can hit iTunes for new episodes and check out some of our old episodes. Thanks for listening.